Evil has been with us for a long time. From the beginning of history, evil has been in the world. It's also been defined in many ways. If we were to interview 50 people, we couldn't guarantee that any two of them would explain it in the same way. And so, from the outset of this program, I'd like to offer you my personal definition of evil. I've said it before, and I'll say it now again, that in my opinion, evil should be equated with the act of self-murder. It's the condition of being psychologically dead. That's a bizarre statement, to be sure. And of course, this process of self-murder doesn't occur overnight. It's a gradual process with many stages and sub-stages. But in our particular age, we need to be understanding something about the anatomy of evil if we're ever to see the back of evil, ever to be rid of it once and for all. And in professional circles, we notice that experts are loath to even use the term evil. We hear them speak of brain disease, and mental derangement, and antisocial behavior, and even insanity. But we might question that these institutions that ostensibly are there to cure these disorders also profit from them, profit from their existence. Some argue that they manufacture disease, and the low levels of success that they have with treating depression and suicide is, in my opinion, based on their fundamental misconceptions about pathology. We hear a lot about disorders, but when do we ever hear about energy, or bioenergy, or chi, or prana, or life force? And we live in a sea of other people, a plasma of human beings, and we go around assuming that our energy is similar to other people. Well, we irrationally go around thinking that just because somebody's nice, they must have a conscience. Well, when it comes to vampires, they may be nice, but they have no conscience and don't care about your welfare at all. They're the chameleons, the human predators, the parasites, if you will, and they're very hard to detect. All manner of experts and psychiatrists have been duped by their facade. The information we present here will be a great help to you should you suffer at their hands. But even if you never encounter a full-blown vampiristic type, you may find yourself at some point in the company of neurotics, narcissists, and sociopaths. Again, this information that we provide now will be great help. Now, this research takes us to the heart of human psychology, to the heart of who we are. Ultimately, it's about how to stay sane in an insane world. And with that said, let's step now into the world and the mind of the psychic vampire. Now, this is a program about violence, violence to other people and violence to oneself. And when we look through history, we see nothing but a catalog of destruction and violence. We've had pogroms and witch hunts, crusades and bloody wars. We've had slave labor and gulags, death squads, satanic child abuse rings, and suicide bombers, not to mention the animal cruelty and the ecocide. And when it comes to self-destruction, we have colossal rates of suicide. Now, evil, if anything, has been increasing in the world. In Japan, for instance, which is strongly conformist socially, there's been an upsurge in brutality in the schools. A massive increase of 23% in 1985 alone. Of course, we're quite technical, scientifically advanced, rationally advanced, but psychologically and emotionally, it's quite a different thing. As Murray Stein, in his book entitled Young on Evil, writes, he says, one could argue that despite all the technical progress of the last several thousand years, moral progress has been absent, and that, if anything, evil is a greater problem in the 20th century than in most. In Prisoners of Hate, Aaron T. Beck, M.D., writes, the violence of humans against humans appalls but continues to take its toll today. The dazzling technological advances of our era are paralleled by a reversion to the savagery of the Dark Ages, unimaginable horrors of war and wanton annihilation of ethnic, religious, and political groups. We have succeeded in conquering many deadly diseases, yet we have witnessed the horrors of thousands of murdered people. Wherever we look, we see persecution, violence, and genocide. There seem to be no limits to the personal misery people inflict on one another. In his book, The Evil We Do, Carl Goldberg says, almost every day in some part of the country, a juvenile commits a murder. Some days, several take place. The United States Department of Justice in 1992 reported that the number of homicides in this country by youngsters, 18 years of age or younger, had increased 300% during the last three decades. The number of killings of a parent alone averages 300 a year. And of course, we know about the fascination with evil and the dark side. Just look at the media, just look at advertising, the horror films, the horror fiction, the comic strips and the games, the fascination with occultism and all brands of Satanism, and the morbid fascination with serial killers. Now, every act has a reason or a motive, and so it is with evil actions. We commit evil because it gives us pleasure, or it asserts our power, or we do so out of an irrational fear of being attacked, or because we're compulsively afraid of those we attack or kill. We might commit a destructive act because we see it as righteous. We only have to listen to the evangelists on television to note their thinly veiled hatred for anyone that doesn't believe as they believe. We may do evil acts because we have little choice, as in wartime with gangs and or syndicated crime. We may be caught up in mob frenzy. Evil acts may be customary. We can certainly see that in the history of certain tribes, like in New Guinea, for instance, that if you don't act in the customary way, you're considered abnormal if you don't act in an evil or violent manner. We may have been conditioned to act in an evil manner. Or we could say that something indefinable causes to act in a malicious or malignant way. And according to author Roy Baumeister, we act in an evil manner because of material gain, because of defense, because of idealism, and that includes patriotism or obedience to authority, or just for sadistic pleasure. Now, vampirism, as I define it, falls under categories 1, 2, and 4, but particularly under categories 2 and 4 of Baumeister's list. History reveals also that a vast majority of the malicious and malignant and evil and violent acts are done by what might be described as the little man, the nondescript, bureaucratic, sort of servile human being who often gets enjoyment from his heinous acts. In technical parlance, these kinds of individuals are known as constitutional psychological inferiors. I simply refer to them as morally inferior beings. Eric Fromm, in his Anatomy of Human Destructiveness, he says that there are thousands of Himmlers living among us. Socially speaking, they do only minor harm in normal life, although one must not underestimate the number of people whom they damage and make thoroughly unhappy. Why do we do evil? Well, as the great American philosopher said once, it's easier to harm others than it is to heal oneself. There's a great wisdom in that statement. Why do we act in an evil manner? Well, being human beings, we may have noted down through time that nature, fate, doesn't necessarily reciprocate our good actions. And that might lead an immoral man to say, well, what the hell? I can act in an immoral way and get away with it. The only thing standing in my way are other people, and they're not particularly noble. And when you think along those lines, you can end up justifying your violent activities. In fact, you may even think that you're superior to other people. You might look at them as being lesser or more conformist because they don't just follow their instincts. Now, society realizes this fact and therefore has construed itself to say we must reward good behavior. But if a child is constantly berated for bad actions and never given approval for his good actions, that child may grow up, as I said, to think that he's living in a world of falsity and hypocrisy, and that it's actually a sign of superiority and strength to just commit harm and violent acts on other people. This superiority versus inferiority dynamic was first addressed by the German psychologist Alfred Adler He was the first one to use the term superiority complex. He noted that children, for instance, who were in families that were interrogative and domineering, who were feeling inferior, would compensate by this superiority complex. The experts have also discovered that language is very important, that criminals, the worst psychopaths, the worst offenders, are the ones with the least ability to express their hurt, express anything in language. So language plays a big role. The person who's able to express themselves better and express their hurt and express what they're feeling is less likely to commit violent acts. Now, Carl Goldberg goes on to say in his book, The Evil We Do, my clinical experience has shown that beneath the vicious persona of violent and destructive people is a great deal of inarticulate hurt, with the fear of still further emotional injury. I was fully aware from my clinical experience, he says, with clients who had committed serious violent acts, that a lack of regret for their behavior was bonded to their severe early psychological trauma. Exploration of their histories revealed that each of the offenders I treated became violent to inure against some great suffering. So this is a very important point. Suffering. It's going to come up a lot in this program. Suffering that is inherited from the parents or the family dynamic, and suffering just in general from being a human in the world. Psychologists like Goldberg point out very importantly that hurt and anger are twins. The person who's not able to express his hurt often expresses anger, and vice versa. The person who can name his feelings and give language to his hurt is again less likely to act out in anger. But of course we know that there's positive aspects of anger as well. Anger can be used as a defense against attack. Depression is rage spread thin, said the great philosopher George Santayana. And he was right. And look at our world today, the suffering from depression and acting out in rage, they're all connected to this inability to express our hurt. Also, another syndrome that occurs in this dynamic is freezing. The person who's frightened of his own anger, frightened of himself, frightened to express that anger, might not act it out, but might instead freeze and armor themselves and have a personality or a character type that could be described as being frozen in order to keep this deep-set rage inside of them, the deep-set hurt that we spoke about. The solution, of course, is to work with the shadow self, not deny who we are, not deny the feelings that we're experiencing, to be okay with legitimate suffering and to work with, as Jung called, our shadow self. In his book Emotional Resilience, David Viscott, speaking of this anesthetized hurt, says that at the heart of every addiction was an anesthetized hurt seeking to be released. Some chemical or self-destructive behavior reinforced the lie and made it more difficult to correct. Let's turn now to the more pernicious form of violence, the kind we do to ourselves. Let's discover about this incredible phenomenon of self-murder. Let's start with a quote from the great Swiss psychologist Carl Gustav Jung. Speaking on self-hate and violence to the self, he says that the man of today, who resembles more or less the collective ideal, has made his heart into a den of murderers, as can easily be proved by the analysis of his unconscious, even though he himself is not in the least disturbed by it. Carl Goldberg, speaking of Sigmund Freud and his work on self-hate, says that among Freud's most important discoveries is the realization that the underlying cause of psychological disturbance is our fear of self-knowledge. Information which, when consciously recognized, induces us to feel weak, incompetent, ashamed, and unworthy, leading to self-hatred. So as far as Freud was concerned, self-hatred is directly connected to this avoidance of self-knowledge, introspection, looking at who we are. But of course, if we talk about self-hatred, the opposite of that is self-love. But unfortunately, we don't live in a culture which has much to say on self-love. This point was evident to some of the greatest philosophers that ever lived. On the subject, Ayn Rand, in her book The Virtue of Selfishness, says that in popular usage, the word selfishness is a synonym of evil. The image it conjures is of a murderous brute who tramples over piles of corpses to achieve his own ends, who cares for no living being and pursues nothing but the gratification of the mindless whims of any immediate moment. Yet the exact meaning and dictionary definition of the word selfishness is simply concern with one's own interests. Eric Fromm, in his book entitled Love, Sexuality, and Matriarchy, again speaking on the word love, says that there is no word in our language which has been more misused and prostituted as the word love. It has been preached by those who were ready to condone every cruelty if it served their purposes. It's been used as a disguise under which to force people into sacrificing their own happiness, into submitting their whole self to those who profited from this surrender. So, in my work, I've always equated love with freedom. And I've gone so far to say that when there is no freedom, there is no love. All you have is pseudo-love. All you have is the act. All you have is some sort of thraldom, romantic thraldom. Love and freedom are synonymous. Two words for the same thing. Where one is, the other is. Where one is not, the other cannot be. And Eric Fromm agrees. He says, it appears from what has been said that love cannot be separated from freedom and independence. In contradiction to the symbiotic pseudo-love, the basic premise of love is freedom and equality. Its premise is the strength, independence, integrity of the self, which can stand alone and bear solitude. Now, the distinguished and psychologist Arno Gruen, in his work entitled The Insanity of Normality, he says that evil has its roots in the perversion of human potential, in people without true selves. Carl Menninger, in his work entitled Man Against Himself, says the destructiveness of mankind appears to include a large amount of self-destructiveness, in paradoxical contradiction to the axiom that self-preservation is the first law of life. Now, if we go to the encyclopedias to look up self-harm or self-hate, we often find it defined as autophobia, and that means phobia against oneself. We read that self-harm in childhood is relatively rare, but the rate has been increasing since the 1980s. Self-harm is listed in the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders as a symptom of borderline personality disorder. However, patients with other diagnoses may also self-harm, including those with depression, anxiety disorders, substance abuse, eating disorders, post-traumatic stress disorders, schizophrenia, and several personality disorders. Self-harm is also apparent in high-functioning individuals who have no underlying clinical diagnosis. The motivation for self-harm varies, and it may be used to fulfill a number of different functions. These functions include self-harm being used as a coping mechanism which provides temporary relief of intense feelings such as anxiety, depression, stress, emotional numbness, and a sense of failure or self-loathing. Self-harm is often associated with a history of trauma and abuse, including emotional abuse, sexual abuse, drug dependence, eating disorders, or mental traits such as low self-esteem or perfectionism. Self-harm is most common in adolescence and young adulthood. Arno Gruen goes on to say, speaking specifically about the repression of our feelings, the repression of our hurt, it is not always easy to recognize in what situations and to what extent we are being cut off from our feelings, but such a phenomena constitutes murder. He goes on to say, we want to escape responsibility because we are deeply afraid of having a self of our own. It is not an abstract responsibility that we find threatening, but rather the responsibility to realize ourselves. And Eric Fromm, he says the majority of well-adapted individuals have lost their own self at an early age and replaced it completely by a social self offered to them by society. They have no neurotic conflicts because they themselves, and therefore the discrepancy between themselves and the outside world, have disappeared. In his book, The Four Agreements, Don Miguel says, in your whole life, nobody has ever abused you more than you have abused yourself. And the limit of your self-abuse is exactly the limit that you will tolerate from someone else. If someone else abuses you a little more than you abuse yourself, you will probably walk away from that person. But if someone abuses you a little less than you abuse yourself, you will probably stay in the relationship and tolerate it endlessly. Well, am I good or am I bad? Am I lovable or unlovable? Am I right or am I wrong? Will I be a failure or a success? Will people like me for who I am or will they not? We're constantly beating ourselves up. We're constantly in a state of self-sadism. And the great psychologists like Eric Fromm have asked why that is. Why do we do that? Why do we even repress and reject our own hurt feelings, key parts of ourselves? I mean, what causes that to happen? Might it not be better just to express it? But we don't do that. So why? Well, the answer is because, as Vernon Howard said, it's a lot easier to harm ourselves and harm other people than to heal ourselves and face ourselves and deal with ourselves as we actually are. It's actually easier to create a pseudo-self, to live in a state of pseudo-love, than it is to walk the Siddhartha road, face the shadow, develop meaning from within ourselves. We're waiting for the world to turn us on. That's easy. Creating meaning for your life from within your own being, that is difficult for most people. And so we have this conflict. Now the Reichian psychologist Alexander Lauen, he gives his readers an example of what it means to be psychically dead. He does this by recounting a conversation he had with a patient. He says, "So I asked Eric what his feelings were." "Feelings?" he exclaimed. "I don't have any feelings. I don't know what you mean by feelings. I program my behavior so that it's effective in the world. My lack of feeling doesn't bother me. I get along perfectly well." The only answer I could make, says Lauen, was, "Well, dead men have no pain and nothing bothers them. You have simply deadened yourself." I thought this remark would sting him. His reply amazed me. "I know I'm dead," he said. Now, another form of self-destruction is quite obviously addiction. Robert A. Johnson, in his book entitled Ecstasy, Understanding the Psychology of Joy, says that so many of our lives are touched by addiction. The successful young entrepreneurs who think they need cocaine to give them a competitive edge, the supermoms who can't get through the day without a tranquilizer, the harried managers who need 2 to 3 drinks every night after work to unwind, the young children who try street drugs because they're already touched by our society's bankruptcy of feeling, the college students who go to parties to get drunk and stoned, the dangerously fast drivers who are addicted to the thrill of speed, the insider traders who make illegal deals on the stock market because they're addicted to the kick of making money, and the perpetual singles who go from lover to lover, addicted to the first glow of romantic love. And Eric Fromm, speaking specifically on masochism, a term normally used technically for self-harm. Violence turned within, violence interjected. Fromm says in his book Escape from Freedom, "The annihilation of the individual self and the attempt to overcome thereby the unbearable feeling of powerlessness are only one side of the masochistic striving. The other side is the attempt to become part of a bigger and more powerful whole outside of oneself, to submerge and participate in it. And this power can be a person, an institution, a god, the nation, conscience, or a psychic compulsion." Note what he said there about losing yourself in another person. It's going to prove very interesting as we move through this program and start studying the vampire in greater and greater depth. This ability to almost parasitically leech off another person and their energy. Keep that in mind. Alexander Lauen, he specifically addresses the problem of inner deadness and chronic outer directedness. He says that in many schizophrenic experiences, we find that the walls of a room play an important role. Hearing voices and seeing things at the walls is a common schizophrenic experience. The most vivid statement by the schizophrenic is that the walls are alive. Now, to understand this remark, we must bear in mind that the schizophrenic perceives movement outside himself, while his perceptions of internal motility is blocked. That is, the schizophrenic perceives the effects of his projection as the reflection from the walls without being aware that he is the source. Lawan happens to believe that all schizophrenics are born from the womb of a cold, indifferent, unloving mother. Again, bear that in mind because we'll be looking at that concept of parenting a little bit later in this program. Arno Gruen, speaking on inner and outer direction, makes the point that the choice of which path we choose is really our own. He says the central issue in individual psychological growth is the choice between two basic developmental directions. Development toward the outer as opposed to the inner world. Development is directed towards the inner world if children receive the kind of love that enables them to experience helplessness without feeling all alone. If this is the case, helplessness will not be perceived as a total abandonment or condemnation, but as a state leading through pain and sorrow to new strength rather than to destruction. In his book Insanity of Normality, he says, the person who is inner-directed and creative has the advantage. For him, there is both the existence of the inner world and the outer world of objects and stimuli. But the outer-directed person who has abolished selfhood, there is only the objective flux with his own vagaries. His life is defined by his external world of other people and things. The kind of personality that is turned to perform in the external world has no inner life and few true feelings. They may simulate feelings, but these are rarely those which are deep, sincere, and transformative. In another place, Gruen says, the other direction, the outer one, involves the dissociation of the experience of helplessness and the denial of the inner world in favor of acquiescence in an externally imposed order in which one's needs and perceptions are preformed, first by parents, later by school, society, and state. And Arno Gruen emphasized throughout his work this incredible relationship, this pathological relationship between the disowned self, the destroyed self, the eliminated self, and the parents and society. He was forever making that link, that the outer-directed person, he's going to be much more accepted and favored in a world of unbelievable stimuli. The world is custom-made for that. It welcomes the outer-directed person. As we said, we don't hear too much in the world about self-love, and we certainly don't hear too much about inner direction and meaning coming from within. We're just sitting around waiting for the world to titillate us and turn us on. And Gruen goes on to say, thanks to their ability to adjust to socially approved patterns of behavior, people without a genuine self all too often give the appearance of having normal and acceptable feelings because they're actually cut off from all feelings except revenge directed at whatever is alive and vital. They seem to be free of fear, anxiety, and tension. Again, bear this in mind when we're talking later about the vampire specifically. That ability to be light and carefree and apparently very effervescent. That could pass as being quite holy and sacred if you're not looking too closely. But the psychologists are saying, you better look closely, because those very traits, as admirable as they are in public, might be a veneer, a facade, behind which lies a cemetery, a psychic cemetery. When we hear a good recording of a soprano singer, it seems like magic, but you can actually hear something about the room. Acoustically speaking, you can hear the room in her voice. She's not just in the room is in her voice. As I said, it's like magic. And this metaphor applies to all of us. We're in the world. So in our facial expressions, in our speech, in our posture, in various expressions, and in our character, we hear the world, so to speak. The world is us, and we are the world. And with this in mind, let's move forward now to examine some of the fascinating relationships between the self-destructive behavior and the society in which we are living, in which we exist. That society has a bearing on our character and on our nature. Now, one of the major themes of this program is a look at how to live sanely in an unsane world. And of course, to do that, we have to look at the world with new eyes, perhaps, to uncover the subtle connections between society, that includes the parents, and the individual. The French author Albert Camus went so far as to describe our age as a century of fear, that is, a century of anxiety and neurosis. And as we'll see later when we deal with the so-called neurotic vampire, we find that anxiety is in fact the nucleus, the center of neurosis. Let's not forget also William Shakespeare, his wonderful play Hamlet, in which a good man, a moral man, falls on hard times and feels inwardly fatalistic and deranged. Why? Because of his society, because of the toxic environment in which he was forced to live. Shakespeare clearly shows you the connections. When Shakespeare goes on to talk to his friend Horatio, he's light and he's much more light in his spirit, more gay. But the moment that his moral companions leave, he falls into shadow, he falls into sorrow. Shakespeare appears to be emphasizing this, the connections between the individual, the moral man, and his corrupt environment. Arno Gruen, speaking specifically about external stimuli, says, "We are surrounded to a great extent by a sea of stimuli, music, radio, television, advertising, pictures, street noises, newspapers, books, architecture, clothing, etc., which we human beings have created ourselves. These stimuli have less to do with our purely physical survival needs than they do with our psychological state. Remove them from our environment, and we will usually feel empty, bored, and apathetic. Indeed, we can say that we seek such stimuli unthinkingly in order to give ourselves the feeling of being alive." Speaking specifically about the artificial society, Arno Gruen says that our lives are becoming a series of performed reactions instead of perceived experiences, and the rapid-fire constant change is becoming a substitute for feelings. We have no chance to linger with ourselves, to ponder over things. Everything is presented to us for instant consumption in bite-sized portions that are often pre-digested as well. And we'll be seeing soon as we progress through the program that this artificial society creates an artificial being. The vampire of which we speak is largely an artificial being. You can't think of the vampire as you would as a normal human being. And the way things are going, the more artificial the world becomes, the more extroverted and outer-directed people become, the more likelihood that vampire proliferates in our world. Speaking about social upheaval, the psychologist Percival Simmons says that separation from the group also tends to break through ego controls and tends to distort rational thinking. Many persons have difficulty maintaining their ego structure in a new and unfamiliar surroundings, particularly where cultural standards differ from those to which they are not accustomed. When a person migrates from the society in which he grew up, which may have been puritanical, to another society which is free and easygoing, it takes a very strong ego to resist modification under the relentless pressure of the new conditions. Equally disturbing is the collapse of established norms within a society. The collapse of society in Germany and Japan following their defeat in the World War has tended to disrupt the ego organization of the citizens of these countries, which leads to a loosening of controls on the one hand and a general lowering of ego integration on the other. Michael E. Staub, in his book Madness is Civilization, writes, "Harvard psychiatrist Robert Coles went so far as to speculate in 1967 that there would never be an end to mental illness due to advances in medical research, because mental illness was a social problem involving the family, the nursery, the neighborhood, the nation, and its economic and political condition. To treat the sickness of the individual, psychiatrists had first to concede the sickness in society." Speaking of the malignant society, Alexander Lowen refers to Freud and his pessimism regarding mankind's future. Lowen writes, "If we follow Freud in his later theories, expressed in Beyond the Pleasure Principle and Civilization in its Discontents, we must assume that absolute emotional health is impossible under the conditions of civilized living." And Yolanda Jacobi, in her book, The Way of Individuation, writes on the dehumanization and conformity and submission that we find more and more in our modern world. She says all too many people do not live their own lives, and generally they know next to nothing about their real natures. They make convulsive efforts to adapt, not to stand out in any way, to do exactly what the opinions, rules, regulations, and habits of the environment demand as being right. They are slaves of what people think and of what people do, etc. And J.A.C. Brown, in his Techniques of Persuasion, says, it is becoming increasingly evident that neurosis is a group malady in which the whole family, and beyond that, society, is involved. And speaking of neurosis, success, and acclaim in the world, Brown says that because some neuroses makes people incompetent at work, we are liable to assume that those without a neurosis would be competent. Whereas the truth is that it is only the incompetent neurotic who is seen by the psychiatrists. And since neurosis is socially defined, we ignore the great bulk of brilliant people who are successful precisely because they are neurotic. Percival Simmons, in his fine book, The Ego and the Self, and speaking about the self in relation to other people, says that the concept of group consciousness and of group identification is necessary for the further development of the self. A child has to learn that he is a boy and different from a girl, that he is white and different from a Negro, that he is poor and different from those that are rich. In these perceptions of difference, the child is learning to identify himself with a group or groups, and these group identifications are intrinsic aspects of the development of the self. Percival Simmons goes on to say, recent discussions have emphasized that self-valuation is to a large extent socially determined. One values oneself in proportion to the values that are expressed towards the individual by the group. As an individual is praised by his group and is selected by it to be the leader or the representative, that individual feels himself enhanced and more confident. One values himself in terms of the group norms and group expectations. In a society in which aggression is the group norm, an individual who displays his aggression thereby enhances his self-esteem. But in a society where aggression is frowned upon, the aggressive individual finds that his self-esteem is lessened. Now, the part of our minds that embodies the social norms and the rules and the conventions is known technically as the superego. But the superego acts in very specific ways. The superego is the seat of ethics. It is the interjector of the demands of society and the parents. The superego has us striving for perfection. It is also the censor of our drives and instincts, those which are taboo to society. It's the cause of repression. It's the voice we hear in our heads of guilt and shame. The problem is, however, that the superego is key to all forms of pathology. It's key to their origin. It's key to their nature. Eric Fromm says, the father's norms are internalized and become the superego. Joel Simmons says, the superego, a product of introjection, represents the uncritical assimilation of the standards and expectations of parents and later of a wider society. The ego, on the other hand, should be thought of as the more critical assimilation of experiences with other people in the family and eventually in the wider society. Ego is based primarily on experience, on logical thinking, and on the development of control. Superego is based on the promises of reward and threats of punishment. Simmons says elsewhere, the child's interpretation of parental demands and prohibitions become magnified so that the superego demands are often more extreme and violent than the actual demands of the parents in reality. So even though the superego is the faculty within us that embodies the social norms and conventions and the prohibitions and permissiveness of our parents, when it comes to censoring and when it comes to judging and creating guilt and shame within us, that voice can actually be more stern, more oppressive than even the parents were, the actual original source. This has a bearing on where we're going in this program when we look at the origins of neurosis and anxiety and so on. Now, Percival Simmons goes on to say, the child's interpretation of parental demands and prohibitions becomes magnified so that the superego's demands are more extreme and violent than the actual demands of the parents in reality. The guilt and punishment which a child feels he deserves and fears for some minor infraction is frequently many times more intense and severe than that which his parents will administer. In the book Meeting the Shadow, the authors write, "In the psychological atmosphere created by parents, siblings, caretakers, and other important sources of love and approval, each child begins the necessary process of ego development. Human adaptation to the society requires the creation of an ego, or an I, to serve as the organizing principle of our growing consciousness. Ego development depends on our repressing what is wrong or bad in us, while we identify with what is perceived and reinforced as good." Percival Simmons, talking about this inner parent or inner tyrant, if you will, says that the superego may criticize the activities of the ego and actually exercise a censorship on impulses and thoughts. Because the superego exercises the functions of a censor, it can make the ego miserable in its efforts to discharge impulses in a spontaneous, natural, and healthy manner. The ego then must react to the superego in much the same way in which it has previously reacted to the parents, either by submitting or by rebelling, or by an alternation between these two methods. Simmons says, because the superego represents the uncritical assimilation of the parental expectations, it is inaccessible to judgment and intelligence. It is this inaccessibility to critical appraisal that makes the superego such a tyrant in many cases and forces the ego to be its slave. Actually, logical judgment is often warped and complicated by guilt resulting from behavior which threatens the superego's demands. That is, the superego may actually cause distortion and warping of thought processes. Most psychologists always identify the ego with reason. And therefore, any conflict between the superego, which again is the inner representative of the world and of the parents, well, any type of conflict between your superego and your ego can be construed as a conflict between reason and irrationality. So is the superego a representative or a faculty of irrational behavior as opposed to behavior? The ego being the rational center? What this means, of course, is that in a family dynamic, it is crucially important, since we have this superego, since everyone has it, all children have it, it is crucially important that the parent acts rationally and gives clear, definable, hopefully rational reasons for their prohibitions. If the parents are not rational and don't give rational explanations to the child for what they say about its behavior, that alone can plant the seeds of not only disharmony, but terrible malignancy and dysfunction down the line. Psychologists traditionally divide consciousness into three. There's the id, the selfish, primitive, childish, pleasure-oriented part of the personality with no ability to delay gratification. There's the superego, which is the internalized societal and parental standards of good and bad and right and wrong behavior. It's the censor or prohibitor. And then there's the ego, the moderator between the id and the superego, which seeks compromises to pacify both. It can be viewed as our sense of time and place. In other words, it's like our reason. So the superego in consciousness can be the agent of repression. It censors the ego, and therefore a malignant or overly tyrannical superego can be responsible for the creation of the pseudo-self. Harville Hendricks divides this so-called pseudo-self into three categories. There's the lost self, those parts of your being that you had to suppress or repress because of the demands of society. There's the false self, which is the facade erected in order to fill the void created by this repression. And there's the disowned self, the negative parts of your false self that met with disapproval. And the disapproval, of course, is the disapproval from the parents and the peers and the friends and the society at large. Percival Simmons defines the job of the ego. The ego may repress its superego and become criminal. Then the ego may, on the other hand, side with society and its inner representatives, with resulting self-control and constriction of behavior. The most constructive relation, however, is that in which the ego mediates between the drives on the one hand and the superego on the other, and effects a satisfactory working relationship between these two forces. So we see that if you don't have a superego, then you have embodied no ethics or morals or rules or conventions, and that can basically make you a criminal in another way. But if the superego is too punitive, as we said, too malignant, then the violence is turned within. The criminality may not be towards society, but it will be towards your own self. Percival Simmons, speaking on the superego and its connection to masochism, says that masochism, the tendency to inflict pain on the self, is recognized as a sadistic drive of the superego against the ego, which corresponds to the punishment which might be administered by parents. Now that we've looked at society in general and how it affects the psyche and its dynamics, let's move more specifically to look at the role of parenting. And psychologists know all too well about these connections between infancy and parenting. The psychologist, American psychologist John Medina, said that if he meets a father who, before his child is even born, asks him, "How can I get my child into Harvard?" is probably a red flag that things are not going to go too well. Roy F. Baumeister, in Evil, Inside Human Cruelty and Violence, writes, "The family is the first and most important source of identity and emotional support. It is a greenhouse where the child feels loved, cared for, accepted, and secure. The prerequisites for development of personal resources." And the experts know that bad behavior is ultimately learned behavior. Those children that were treated dysfunctionally by their parents almost inevitably go and become dysfunctional in their own future relationships. Percival Simmons, in his book The Ego and the Self, says that a child develops self-feeling also in part by taking on the role of other persons. As a child identifies himself with his parents and his brothers and sisters and attempts to copy them in his methods of eating, dressing, playing with toys and the like, he develops more definite feelings of himself. And Carl Goldberg puts the matter in a nutshell and writes that the destructive personality begins in childhood as a state of extreme vulnerability to mistreatment by early caretakers, proceeds to feelings of impacted self-hatred and then to self-protection by an indifference to other people, followed by attempts to feel better about oneself by acting as if one is a superior person, and finally to the transformation of the shamed person's self-contemptuous personality to that of perpetrator of outrage against others in order to demonstrate one's superiority. Karen Horney, in her work The Neurotic Personality of Our Time, says, "A child feels keenly whether love is genuine and cannot be fooled by any fake demonstrations. More frequently than not, in my experience," she says, "the essential lack of warmth is camouflaged and the parents claim to have in mind the child's best interest." R.D. Lang says, "I've never known a schizophrenic who was loved." And of course, the child is caught in a conundrum. What can it do? It has its need for the parent, it has its fear of the parent, and it also has the contempt within it for the way that it's being treated by its parents. What can it do with that conflict? Now, Michael E. Staub, in Madness is Civilization, he says that in 1960, Ronald D. Lang concluded his first book, The Divided Self, A Study of Sanity and Madness, with a case history of a psychotic. Lang recounts the life story of Julie, who was in her mid-20s when Lang met her. She had been institutionalized at the age of 17 when she was diagnosed with schizophrenia. Julie suffered from auditory hallucinations and delusions of persecution. She believed the world was coming to an end, and she believed she was not a real person and spoke and incomprehensible gibberish. Yet, a statement Julie repeated appeared to Lang to have special significance. Julie said to him that a child has been murdered. Eric Fromm clearly understood that many families are little more than domestic gulags, and he writes that many married couples stay together for this reason. The marriage gives them the opportunity to experience hate, quarrels, sadism, and sublimation. People stay together, not in spite of their fights, but because of them. Masochistic behavior, the pleasure in suffering or submitting, has one of its roots in this need for excitement. Masochistic persons suffer from a difficulty of being able to initiate excitation and of reacting readily to normal stimuli. In John Medina's Brain Rules for Baby, we read, if marital hostility continues, the children are statistically more likely to display antisocial behavior and aggression when they enter school. These kids have more health problems, particularly with coughs and colds, and are at greater risk for pediatric depression and anxiety disorders. They don't complete high school as often as their peers and attain lower academic achievement when they do. Divorce is a convenient target. We observe that kids are still paying for it years later. Children from divorced households are 25% more likely to abuse drugs by the time they're 14. They're more likely to get pregnant out of wedlock. They are twice as likely to get divorced themselves. In school, they get worse grades than children in stable households. And they are much less likely to receive support for college. When marriages stay together, 88% of college-bound kids will receive consistent support for their college education. He goes on to say that 3-year-olds who were spanked more than twice a month were 50% more likely to be aggressive by age 5, and that capricious and dictatorial parents have the most unhappiest and socially inept kids. And when it comes to freedom and free will, I write that there is no such thing as free will as far as children are concerned. It's an illusion. Parents dominate the minds of their children completely. They push them to be aggressive and competitive and to think that they're better than everyone else around them, with little to no reason. What a child hears and believes is accepted on faith, not proof. If family members act as if their family is the greatest, the child does not question it. If he is told implicitly or explicitly that he is bad, inadequate, undeserving, stupid, or evil, he's bound to believe it by way of his identification with his parents. After a child enters school, he is subject to yet more instruction and domination. Freedom is just a word. It is hard to discover in the life of any young person. In fact, if a child is told to carry some burden or do something hard, the child will not only strive to do it to the best of his ability, but he'll beat himself up, act sadistically towards himself, get into all sorts of guilts and shames because he wasn't able to do whatever his irrational parents asked of him, wasn't able to fulfill their demands. The mystic Osho said that everybody is living in bondage, because everybody who brought you up wanted to have power over you, to enjoy the mastery over you. And children are the most helpless people in the world, the most exploited class. It is not the proletariat who are the most exploited class. It is not the women who are the most exploited class. It is the children who are the most exploited class. Alexander Laun, speaking of powerless children, says that children are often accused of seeking power over their parents, when all they want is to have their needs understood and responded to. Infants are totally dependent and can only appeal by crying. Children are also really powerless. It is the parents who are omnipotent with respect to children, for they literally hold the power of life or death over them. The parent's narcissism is projected onto the child. I'm special, therefore my child is special. I hope you can also see some of the inherent vampirism or the tendencies of vampirism that exist in these dynamics. Dysfunctional parents living with their children or living off their children. Alexander Laun, speaking of the powerlessness of children, says, if we drop the concept of infantile omnipotence, then we may seek the cause for grandiosity in the parent's relationship to the child. rather than in the child's relationship to the parents. A boy doesn't think of himself as a prince through any failure of normal development. If he believes himself to be a prince, it is because he is raised in that belief. How children see themselves often reflects how their parents saw and treated them. The great Thomas Sars, speaking of self-hate, says, "The parent is the paternal leader who is assigned by himself to remove the burden of survival from the shoulders of his children. The child," he says, "cannot know that his image of his parents is false. He is weaker because of his inability. Later, he will be deeply ashamed at himself for having this image and for loving the unloving." The American psychologist Nathaniel Brandon, in his work Taking Back the Disowned Self, writes about childhood submission. He says, "A child does not have a conceptual knowledge of his own needs, nor does he have sufficient knowledge to comprehend the behavior of his parents. But at times, his fear and pain may be expressed as overwhelming and incapacitating. And so, in order to protect himself, in order to remain able to function, in order to survive, it may seem to him, he often feels, wordlessly and helplessly, that he must escape from his inner state, that contact with his emotions has become intolerable. And so, he denies his feelings. The fear and pain are not permitted to be experienced, expressed, and thus discharged. They are frozen into his body, barricaded behind walls of muscular and physiological tension, and a pattern of reaction is inaugurated that will tend to occur again and again when he is threatened by a feeling he does not wish to experience." So there we have it, the confirmation that you either act out in anger, but if you fear your own emotions, and if you fear the caregivers who act like tyrants towards you, one of the other reactions not only is self-denial, but this frozen personality type, this frozen character. Now, Eric Fromm, in Escape from Freedom, speaks about this interjected hostility. One of the earliest suppressions of feelings, he says, concerns hostility and dislike. The child starts by giving up the expression of his feelings and eventually gives up the feeling itself. He is taught to suppress the awareness of hostility and insincerity in others. It does not take long for the child to reach the maturity of the average adult and to lose the sense of discrimination between a decent person and a scoundrel. And so now you see why we're going into all of this. All of these dynamics, all of this child abuse, all of this malignancy in parenting and in society contributes to an erosion of reason, to an erosion of the child's intelligence. The intelligence is going to need later on when it needs to protect itself, when it walks out into the world and needs a rational understanding of what makes people tick. You take that away, you mess with the hard wiring of a child's mind, and that child now becomes vulnerable to every vampiristic creature that comes its way. It won't even know what to do should it even realize what's taking place. Who's it going to go to? Who's it going to trust? It has no even inner concept of boundaries or intuitive understanding. This is what makes the world that we're living in today. This is what constitutes the world we're living in today. Arno Gruen says, "The greater the degree of submission, the less likely the awareness of self-hatred." He says, "Most children play a masquerade from the early years after they realize that the expression of their uniqueness is not something desired by the parents." Arno Gruen, speaking specifically about self-destruction, says, "Again and again, in our search for a love that was never there, we pursue self-destruction. We believe love to be in the very place where we cannot possibly have it. In this way, we repeat the original rejection and keep proving to ourselves that nothing can come our way. And then, if real love should someday cross our path, we reject it. For who could love us when we are so inadequate? The attempt to win the approval of the very people who in fact negate us as human beings becomes the driving force in our life." He says, "It all begins with fear. The fear of being helpless, a fear so great that we block out all memory of the helplessness which characterizes the beginning of human existence, instead of accepting it and integrating it into our experience. For many men, their rejection of this fundamental human quality reduces their life to a farce. He says, if children were never given cause to feel that they are loved and respected for their own sake, the helplessness with which they are confronted at every stage of their development elicits uncontrollable fear. Children's tiny size, their powerlessness, their insignificance, except as objects that make others feel significant, in short, their inferiority, make it impossible for them to discover their own self. They will then either experience psychic disintegration or find coherence in the structure provided by their parents. That is why helplessness is equated with loss of self. The classic way out of their despair over this is the one offered by society's power, specifically power over others. Power, this unspoken promise, is the cure for the child situation. So, the fist that crushes the tyrant's head becomes a tyrant in its stead. The child is as the parents is. The child is as society is. Society is just manufacturing self-destroyed souls who will act in a destructive way to other people and to themselves. Are we getting a handle now on the roots of evil, the roots of pathology? In his book, Betrayal of the Self, Arno Grun specifically deals with the mother, who he sees as the primary cause of deviant psychosexual development in children. If the self is not permitted, he says, to develop independently, it will be formed by the will of the mother. The mother's consciousness and her self-image are the determining factors in the development of our own self. To the extent that she has failed to develop an adequate autonomy of her own, her self-esteem will be based on feelings and needs far removed from a truly autonomous person. As a consequence, the way she regards her own child, and thus how the child later sees itself in her eyes, will necessarily reflect these limitations. Gruen writes, if little boys feel that they cannot separate from their mother, perhaps this is caused by the way some women succeed in making their sons overly attached to them. Direct seductiveness produces the same result as unattainability. In both cases, the child learns that what matters most is to possess the other person. But this situation is not easy to detect, since countless men run after those very women who basically have nothing to give them. The pathology I'm referring to here is the great quest of love in those quarters where none is to be found. The woman who has nothing to offer becomes the object of our intense desire. The tacit assumption is that women who do not show love must be hiding it, withholding it. Women who want to give us love, on the other hand, they can't be worth anything. If they were, they would hide it as their most treasured possession. So we see that one pathology is born out of another pathology. It's just one big, hideous, inverted tree of pathology. Gruen says that the mother exercises greater power over her male child precisely because of his eatable desires towards her. She can use the child's erotic ardor to manipulate him, thus causing untold damage to his psyche. He says, what happens when the mother does not react appropriately, when she does not respond lovingly to the child's demands? This can mean only that the individual will be unable from the very outset to develop an integrated personality. The infant will be totally deprived of the possibility of learning anything about its own nature. Everything that could nurture one's own autonomy is despised. A relentless drive for success and achievement replaces the impetus towards autonomy. Eric Fromm talks about the malignant fixation on the mother. He says the warm, erotically and often sexually tinged tie to the mother is what Freud had in mind when he described the Oedipus complex. While this type of incestuous fixation is most frequent, there is another, much less frequent kind of incestuous fixation that has a very different quality and may be called malignant. It is the type of incestuous fixation that is related to necrophilia. In fact, it might be considered one of the earliest roots. I'm speaking of children in whom no effective bonds towards mother emerge to break through the shell of autistic self-sufficiency. Now, we are familiar with extreme forms of such self-sufficiency in the case of autistic children. These children never break out of the shell of their narcissism. They never experience the mother as a love object, but rather look at them as if they were inanimate objects, and they often show a particular interest in mechanical things. Now, J.C. Rheingold, in his book The Fear of Being a Woman, speaks about the castrating mother, because he questions that the fear of castration that exists between the young son and the father. But some psychologists like Rheingold are questioning that, and they speak of a phenomenon of the castrating mother. He says that classical theory has it that the boy fears castration by father as punishment for his sexual interest in mother. This is not verified by my clinical experience. It is his mother whom he fears. The mother cares for and disciplines the child, and it is her attitudes towards excretory function and the genital organs and autoerotic activity that basically determine the child's fears. It is the rule in my experience for the patient to reveal the mother as the agent of mutilation. Throughout life, the man fears the woman as castrator, not the man. He goes on to say, the withdrawing, self-absorbed mothers, the efficient but affectionless mothers, the cruel, persecuting mothers, the anxiously over-solicitous and over-protective mothers, the rigidly controlling, domineering, and intrusive mothers, the seductive and castrating mothers, the puritanical and guilt-breeding mothers, the mothers who tyrannize by illness, more often feigned than real, the martyred and dolorous mothers, the schizophrenogenic mothers, the suicide-fostering mothers, the mothers who do not release a child from symbiosis, the mothers who exploit a child to satisfy their own conscious and unconscious needs, who scapegoat it or drive it into delinquency, the mothers who vacillate between hostility and remorse. All of these metaphorically castrating women. And what mothers can do to sons, that more and more concretely, dates, brides, wives can do to grown men. Arno Gruen goes on to speak about the consequences to all this aberration and deviancy. It is our children, he says, who we do not allow to have a self, who take revenge on us and on the world by sacrificing themselves to their last breath for a leader, a holy man, or God. History is full of examples of the heroic deeds, so to speak, of children in wars and battles. Even today, they run through minefields and die for higher causes because they do not have a self. And children know exactly, he says, when their parents are taking advantage of their helplessness and protracting it in order to prop up their own feelings of self-worth. Well, the point he's making is that, look, if you don't live for yourself, you have to live for someone else or something else. Makes perfect sense. Gruen goes on to say, the rage that is aroused because their autonomy has been destroyed becomes a destructive drive in its own right and stimulates their desire for power. If nothing happens to relieve their situation, if they're not treated humanely, for example, children soon learn that pain itself is an effective means of gaining power over others. They understand that pain can alter their own mood, and they begin to assume that everyone and everything can be controlled by inflicting it. The child's rage is directed against his own suffering and sense of aliveness, for these are apparently what caused the parents' oppressive behavior in the first place. Percival Simmons, speaking about this rage, says, if the parental images are deflated early through disappointment, neglect, or cruelty, the ego of the child is left without adequate support, and the many problems confronting the child tend to overwhelm him. Arno Gruen, speaking about rage and aggression in our pathocratic world of wars, gangs, crime, and domestic abuse, and so on, he says the source of aggression and destructiveness lies in our culture, not in the individual. And everything that reinforces the fragmentation of our personality and closes off access to our inner world contributes to the creation and growth of our destructive drives. The aggression is a response to a decrease in autonomy. Parental suppression of the child's feelings and spontaneous responses succeeds in making the child obedient. But that only conceals and at the same time intensifies the aggression. Art Martin, in the book Your Body is Talking, Are You Listening? Speaking about rejection, he says that the body-mind is a delicate, awesome machine that operates on a very rigid protocol, as does a computer. The results of addiction, mental dysfunction, pain, illness, and disease can be traced back to earlier emotional trauma and how we were treated as children by our primary caregivers. My research, he says, has shown that 7 out of 10 children are rejected before they're even born. Parents write into a young child's computer every time they have a negative or positive dialogue with the child, who has no sensor in its mind to interpret input. By their 3rd year, many children have already set up their life path to become self-destructive. And some experts now studying infancy and child development have discovered that it is about the age of 3. That the attitude of the mother towards her child dramatically shifts and becomes a lot colder. This is not the case for all mothers, obviously. We're not generalizing here. But we are saying that if and when the relationship dynamic takes a turn for the worst, particularly involving the mother-son, mother-daughter relationship, it is often around the age of 3 that it happens. Now, in my other works, I've spoken about some of these psychological dynamics, and one in particular. I refer to it as the identification with the object of our hate, given that we now have animosity, antipathy, and hatred, and now that we have this inner conflict. Instead of dealing with it in a healthy way, we often identify with the very people and their power, the very people who cause us to be in this state of deremption and inner chaos. Arno Gruen speaks about it and says, usually children submit in order to partake of the power oppressing them. Out of this self-hatred grows a readiness for even more submission. And Alexander Lowen says that rejection is an intolerable situation for a child. In itself, the frustrated longing for love is extremely painful, but the consequent sense of being unlovable and the conclusion that it must be due to some fault or failure in oneself is devastating. The child sees no way out of this impossible position than to accept the offer of specialness and intimacy. Acceptance amounts to almost total identification with the rejecting parent. At the same time, the child must reject the self that the parent found objectionable, namely bodily feelings and the desire to be independent. Talk about conformity. Talk about submission. The child rejects itself in order to gain the approval of the rejecting, unloving parent. The child now lives its entire life into adulthood, chronically dependent on the approval of those who will never, ever give that approval. Are we understanding something about the state of the Western world right now, the state of our planet? It mirrors, as I've said so many times throughout my works, it mirrors, the state of the world mirrors the state of the psyche. In fact, the experts know. They're fully aware of the fact that those who've had a history of rejection submit very easily. Well, of course, in tests that they've done with various groups, those children or those candidates, those participants in the experiment who have a history of rejection will always want to join in. It's the same thing in society. The more that you feel isolated, alienated, and rejected, the more you're likely to submit to authority, just to belong, just not to feel alienated. Arno Gruen speaks about the problem and says that children cannot live with the awareness that their needs and perceptions are rejected or denied unless their psychic structure is so altered that as a result, they are able to deny their true needs. To deny their inner needs, children must either completely or partially split them off. This dissociation involves a basic shift. In order not to be forced to perceive that father and mother are causing them pain, children will search themselves for the cause of their despair. This tragedy, which leads to children's surrender of self, consists not only in dissociation of their inner world, but beyond that, They must see the lack of parental love as the result of a defect in themselves. As a result, they will shoulder the supposed guilt for the lack of love they sense. So now we have guilt as a factor. Of course, guilt always has to be separated from shame. They're slightly different. They're not quite the same. But the kid is riddled with shame and riddled with guilt because he's taking the blame within himself for the errors of his betters. One of the consequences of this, when you've denied yourself, is again the chronic externalization and outer directedness. Arne Gruen speaks of it. He says, the child will shunt aside their inner processes, disregard their own needs, expectations, and perceptions, and organize their lives on the basis of what lies outside the self. Along with this, their image of reality will shift in order to adapt to the ostensible coherence of a world of pseudo-feelings. Children begin to hate everything in themselves that could bring them into conflict with parental expectations. Speaking of parental denial, Scott Peck, in his book People of the Lie, says that whenever a child is brought for psychiatric treatment, it is customary to refer to him or her as an identified patient. By this term, we psychotherapists mean that the parents have labeled the child as a patient, namely someone who has something wrong and is in need of treatment. More often than not, as we proceed with the evaluation of the problem, we discover that the source of the problem lies not in the child, but rather in his or her parents, family, school, or society. We usually find that the child is not as sick as its parents. Any experienced psychotherapist knows that unloving parents abound and that the vast majority of such parents maintain at least some degree of loving pretense. Well, when we say to a child, oh, you're not really hurt, you're not really tired and sick, you really don't want that, stop acting like a child, or you're acting like a fool, or you don't want him to be your friend, you don't want a guy like him, or it can get worse when you're actually defining the child in the company of other people, when you say things like, well, he's rather careless, or he's clumsy, he's talkative, she's so delicate, she's a daydreamer, she's a fidget, he's a serious type, he's sly, she's a gossip, he's tough. Or it can become worse. The defining can be an act of controlling the child. You don't deserve that. You're terrible for thinking such a thing. See, it's your fault. Now look at what you've done. You're never going to make it. That's not a nice thing to say. Smile. Of course, there are more extreme cases of this. You're better off dead. You shouldn't have been born. No one likes you. No one cares about you. The world is against you. You'll never make it. You'll never amount to anything. You're weird. You should be a real man or woman. You're a fool to think that things will improve or that you'll ever make it. And the psychologists know that when they're talking about self-destruction and masochism, that deprivation, if a child suffers deprivation, it's more likely to become what Freud referred to as the oral type. And if the parents are more suppressive and just prohibitive, it's more likely that then the child will develop masochistic traits. But of course, it's all a combination. It's all just one big porridge of complexes. Alexander Lowen defines masochism as sadism towards the self and says that it's usually found prevalent in teenagers by the age of like 13 or 15. Masochistic traits start taking hold. He says that all masochists show an inordinate need to be approved. They strive to please, hoping that approval will bring them love. He goes on to say that the central problem of masochism is the seeming need of the masochist to derive satisfaction and pleasure from pain or from experiences which others regard as unpleasant. The need to suffer was interpreted as an attempt to assuage the superego, to allay the pangs of a guilty conscience. Masochists are prone to fantasy. Of course, in those realms of fantasy, the only place they can go to be what? To be powerful, to be omnipotent, to be superior. They certainly can't do it amongst the tyrants in which they have found themselves. So fantasy, fantasy, fantasy. And look at our world. Look at the games. Look at the media. Look at the television. And look at the many criminals who later on go on to confess that, yes, they were avid fantasizers because that was the only realm in which they could live out their fantasies, which became darker and darker and more morbid and more sinister as time went by. We're looking at the roots of all of this. We're looking at the roots of this kind of pestilence. Most importantly, again, to be emphasized again, the role of the superego. Lauen and these other psychologists, these other experts who've looked so deeply into the human psyche are saying again and again and again that the narcissist, the masochist, the neurotic, and as we'll find out later on, the vampire, they all have a very strong superego. But it's now been noted that superego, remember, that embodiment of all the rules and regulations of society, is not necessarily the same thing as conscience. It's not necessarily the same thing as one's soul. It doesn't necessarily breed human empathy. That's something different again. That's found in the good and the moral human being. Now, on the question of sadism, Adolf Guggenbuhl Craig, in the book The Demonic Side of Sexuality, says that the joy of destroying others is related to self-destructiveness. Thus, it is not surprising that sadism and masochism appear together. The self-destructive killer is in the center of the archetypal shadow, the center of an irreducible destructiveness in human beings. Then when we act out in anger, we're talking here about sadism, okay, masochism is violence directed at the self. Sadism is violence directed towards everybody else. But society doesn't accept anger. You can't act out. You can't act violently to other people in the streets. People do, but society doesn't like it. Well, that's interesting. So the very society then that causes us to repress our hurt and repress our emotions, to perhaps freeze, to then give rise to all forms of masochism and sadism, then even if we try to be sadistic or act out inappropriately, we'll be locked up for it. I'd call that a no-win situation. The whole problem is summed up by Arno Gruen. He says, a distorted development of autonomy is the root cause of the pathological and ultimately evil element in human beings. Now that we've examined the two kinds of violence and the role of society and parents, we can take a step forward to dig more deeply into the etiology or the history of vampiristic behavior. As I mentioned earlier, this program takes us into the realm of psychology and pathology, and there are many pathological states, and the vampire, a vampiristic person, could fall under several of those categories. That doesn't mean that a person with a pathological problem, a pathological syndrome like, say, neurosis, is necessarily a vampire or a vampiristic kind of person. But it does mean that if you ever encounter or observe a vampiristic person, it's more than likely that they will have or show aspects that psychologists are familiar with, aspects of these other pathological states. And as I said, there's a long list of these pathological states, but in the length of our program, we have time only to visit and analyze or study three of them, three very important ones. We'll be studying the neurotic vampire, the narcissistic vampire, and the sociopathic or psychopathic vampire. Let's start with the neurotic vampire. Now, many people suffer from psychiatric maladies. Carl Goldberg says that a study of representative sample of 8,098 Americans found that 48% suffered from at least one psychiatric problem during their lifetime. And of course, these pathological states, there's a whole spectrum of them. They can be benign, like histrionic personality disorder, to the more extreme ones of sadistic personality disorder, and of course, vampirism. When it comes to neurosis, we find that it's on the increase. Alexander Lauen, in his book Narcissism, says, I have seen a marked change in the personality problems of the people consulting me. The neuroses of earlier times, represented by the incapacitating guilts, anxieties, phobias, or obsessions, are not commonly seen today. Instead, I see more people who complain of depression. They describe a lack of feeling and inner emptiness, a deep sense of frustration and unfulfillment. This absence of feeling gives one the impression of unreality about these people. Their performance, socially, sexually, and in the work world, seems too efficient, too mechanical, too perfect to be human. They function more like machines than people. In fact, the term neurosis is rarely used. Since about the 1980s, psychologists and psychiatrists and clinicians prefer to speak of a neurotic personality trait. Pathological states of consciousness, irrational states of consciousness, include neurosis, a psychosis, schizophrenia, multiple personality disorder, manic depressiveness, obsessive compulsive, paranoid, the sociopathic or antisocial type. There's narcissism, sadism, there's dependent personality disorder, depersonalization, derealization, dissociation, fanaticism, phobia, aggression, and of course, let's never forget the passive aggression. But psychologists like Eric Fromm are really aware that these so-called disorders are basically surface disorders. They themselves have a deeper etiology, a deeper and earlier cause. They overlie something even more profound, even more deeply seated in the psyche. Fromm says that most of the symptoms that are given by mainstream psychologists and psychiatrists for people are themselves but side effects of deeper psychic issues. So when we hear terms like depression or split personality or obsessive compulsive, etc., we think that this explains something when it only partially diagnoses the situation. A greater existential condition exists below these comfortably vague technical phrases. And one of those deeper causes, I think it was mentioned briefly earlier, is the whole question of suffering, the avoidance of suffering. We don't want to look at it. We don't want to acknowledge or give language to the hurts and the sufferings that we've experienced. We're against what Jung called legitimate suffering and loath to examine the whole question of what we've lost in order to become ourselves. I mean, it's obvious, isn't it, that we've all experienced more failures and setbacks in life than we have had successes. Well, that's just the way it is. Instead of having a problem with that, accept it. Be okay with it. Look at the fact that you have had successes and look at those other setbacks as challenges. That's the more healthy attitude to take. But when it comes to the actual origin of these so-called disorders, we've already seen that they grow out of a chronic need for approval as well as the avoidance of self-knowledge. They arise from our misuse of free will, because some have argued that free will only applies to whether we choose to be ourselves or not. And that's worth repeating again. That's right. Many philosophers, many psychologists have said, look, the only free will you really have is the free will to decide whether you're going to be yourself or not. As Michel Foucault and so many other great thinkers understood, maybe all other kinds of freedom, political and social and what have you, that's just phraseology, that's just rhetoric. When you really closely examine these concepts, you don't find much back of them. But what you decide in your own mind, that's an act of free will. So if there is any free will, it's the free will to be yourself or not, as the case may be. And Scott Peck is aware of this dynamic of how much we've lost in order to be the people we are today. In his book, The Road Less Traveled, he lists some of these transitions or rites of passage. He says we have to, in life, outgrow our state of infancy, our fantasy of omnipotence, our desire for total dominion and possession over others. We have to outgrow our dependencies, our false ideas about our parents, our fantasy of immortality. Later in life, we have to give up our authority over our children or the power that we've received. Towards the end of our lives, we have to give up our physical health and physical agility. And then finally, we all have to give up life itself. I've often emphasized in my work also that any kind of disorders, all these pathological disorders that we're discussing here, are ultimately, or they ultimately boil down to a way of seeing. You can see life in a godly way, you can see life in a devilish or demonic way. It all boils down to a way of seeing. And if it is accepted that it's a way of seeing, then we have total choice over that way of seeing. If we can be dependent, we can be independent. We don't necessarily need a man in a white coat to adjust us or fix us so that we make the change. We can do it ourselves. If we're one way, it implies that we can, by way of choice and correct exercise of free will, be another way. And Frank Bruno addresses this concept of way of seeing in his book, It's Okay to Be Neurotic. He says that the cognitive viewpoint asserts that neurosis is due to thinking incorrectly about the world, including the social world of other people. One of the principal founding figures associated with this viewpoint, Albert Ellis, states that irrational ideas induce adverse emotional states. So irrational ideas, irrational ways of seeing. We've got to look into why we have those irrational ideas. We've got to question whether we see reality as it really is, or do we have ideas about reality. Art Martin, he says, there is no disease, illness, or dysfunctional behavior that just comes in and affects us by happenstance. Your mind controls every action you take and every situation that happens to you. S. H. Folks, in the book Psychotherapy, says, the original neurotic manifestation in the childhood situation is but a symptom of a total constellation, a family neurosis, so to speak. The acute neurotic breakdown in the adult is a product of interactional processes in which a number of people are actively involved. He's basically saying there that neurosis isn't organic. It's environmental. Its roots are in the domestic situation and in the relationship between the self and the world at large. Arno Grun lets us know that if we have a false self, we'll probably experience false love. He says, a man fights for a self that is not a true self. It's only a shell, dependent on abstractions that do not serve life itself, but rather its concealment. The great misfortune is that, disregarding what our heart tells us, we live according to the ideology of a mutilated self, going along with pre-programmed kinds of love that are not love at all. In addition, there are people who play, as it were, a game within a game of being loved. They are the truly evil ones. They hide their actions behind the lie of being loving, and in so doing, manage to get by. So Gruen is saying here that the pretense of love, the pretense of pseudo-love, becomes a shield behind which the most evil people exist. And they can ply their trade by creating this facade, this mask. We're going to see how important that is later on as we proceed through the program. On the relationship of neurosis and the ego, Percival Simmons says that a neurosis is a disease of the ego, a sign that the ego has been unsuccessful in effecting a synthesis of conflicting elements within. Consequently, a neurosis is in part a conflict between the concept of the self as expressed in its wishes and the valuation of the self as expressed in its superego standards. A neurosis, or even a psychosis, is a sign of ego weakness, indicating that the ego is insufficient to gratify the basic needs of the individual and that it is forced to seek more primitive methods of meeting these needs. A neurosis strikes at the functioning of the ego and causes it to lose its effectiveness in perceiving, feeling, thinking, or acting. When anxiety threatens, the ego puts restrictions on its own organization and relapses to levels of functioning which characterize a more infantile condition. The egos of neurotics are restricted because of the necessity of devoting some of the available energy to maintaining defense mechanisms against unacceptable impulses. So Simmons is saying here, like we touched upon earlier, that maybe the superego is, or let's just say the malignant superego, the actions of the malignant superego not only suppress the ego, but help with regression, help to reduce us back to some sort of infantile level of consciousness. So having a conscience, having empathy, opens us to the world of other people and different levels of caring and compassion and so on. But the effects of the superego can do the opposite. Those effects can not only create a pseudo-self, and from that comes the pseudo-love and the camouflage that evil people hide behind, and the freezing that can take place when you're so riddled with guilt and shame, but can also reduce us back progressively to an infantile level of existence. Now, as we said, the ego, or the reason, is the only part of us that can do something about this. It's the mediator between the pleasure principle and the reality principle. And in order to protect itself, in order to try and find some harmony and balance, it uses what is known as defenses. But there's many of them. Some of the ego's well-known defenses are repression, denial, denial of denial, regression, if need be, dissociation, distortion, the famous projection, or as it used to be called, transference, introjection, or also known as somatization, compensation, sublimation, and so on. Now, central to neurosis specifically is the concept of gratification and its delay, whether or not you or I can delay our need for gratification. On the subject, Percival Simmons says that some neurotics hold to the belief that to postpone gratification is a sign of weakness which damages their self-respect. They believe that the strong individual is one who tolerates no hindrance to his pleasures. In fact, there's even a state known as borderline personality disorder. It's a mild schizophrenic situation in which it's defined by specialists as saying the person simply cannot delay gratification. It's just simply not possible. They want something and they want it now. Well, check out the advertisements, the media, check out our world and see what the etiology of that syndrome may be. Now, neurotic traits include shyness and perfectionism, grandiosity, self-aggrandizement, self-pity, fatalism, worry, fear, paranoia, blame or excusing one's fault. Can include irrational thinking and over-emotionality, certainly guilt and shame, performance anxiety, high and unrealistic expectations, an overactive imagination, and of course, fantasization. Now, earlier we mentioned that the nucleus of neurosis, of neurotic tendencies, is anxiety, angst. So let's explore anxiety and how that factors into this whole dynamic. In the Dynamics of Human Adjustment, Percival Simmons accurately notes that it would surprise most persons to realize how much of their behavior is motivated by a desire to escape anxiety by either reducing it or disguising it in one way or another. Rollo May, in his book The Meaning of Anxiety, says that more than three decades ago, Freud singled out anxiety as the crucial problem of emotional and behavioral disorders. Further development of psychoanalysis has only substantiated his proposition, until it is now recognized on all sides that anxiety is the fundamental phenomena of neurosis, or in Horney's term, the dynamic center of neuroses. But not only in psychopathology, in the actions of normal people as well as abnormal, it is now recognized that anxiety is much more prevalent than was suspected several decades ago. Of course, it might be difficult for some of us to understand what anxiety is. Well, imagine hunger, physical hunger. Let's use a physical metaphor, starvation, or some sort of irritation on the skin, like burning. It's a panic state, but of course it's not physical, it's psychological. The leading expert on neuroses, Karen Horney, in her book, The Neurotic Personality of Our Time, writes, "I declare that in the neuroses of our time, hostile impulses are the main psychological force promoting anxiety." Anxiety can also be described as worrying about worrying, catastrophizing, worst-case scenario outcomes. And often one gets into a state of anxiety or panic when one gets flooded emotionally, emotional flooding, when things get just too much. How do we protect against anxiety? Well, in our culture, we either try to secure affection. The principle is, if you love me, you won't hurt me. As we saw earlier, you submit and you comply. You become inferior. You attempt to gain more power than your adversary. The idea being that if I'm a dictator, an oppressor, if I have power, then I can't be hurt. Or we're back to the freezing again. Or let's say the withdrawing. A person becomes hermetic and withdraws. If I go within my shell, I'm protected. Of course, the old adage, the walls you build to keep others out become the walls that keep you in. Sigmund Freud himself, in his work, The Problem of Anxiety, writes, the first anxiety experience of the human being, at least, is birth. And this means, objectively, separation from the mother, and could be likened to a castration of the mother, in accordance with the equation that the child equals the penis. Freud goes on to say that the danger situation is the recognized, remembered, and anticipated situation of helplessness. Anxiety is the original reaction to helplessness in the traumatic situation, which is later reproduced as a call for help in the danger situation. Anxiety rose as a response to a situation of danger. It will be regularly reproduced thenceforth whenever such situation reoccurs. Freud made a point to say that this kind of anxiety, this kind of fear, is more a phenomena of the ego, and obviously the superego, but specifically the ego, not the id. The id is identical with the pleasure principle. So the anxiety is, its origin is the ego. He says, the neurotic is then distinguished from the normal person in that his response to these dangers is disproportionately increased. Yet against the return of the original traumatic anxiety situation, even maturity offers no adequate protection. There may exist for every one a limit beyond which his psyche fails in the attempt to cope with the demands which the excitation in question makes upon him. Again, the flooding. Each person has a different setting. Each person's ego is slightly differently calibrated. So it's just a matter of that. But once you become flooded with emotion, then anxiety will inevitably occur. And Freud, like Camus, believed that our society is just an age of neurosis, because it throws so much stimulus at us, so much stimuli, that this can overload the mind, overload the brain. It can actually freeze the brain by just having too much going on, too much extroversion. He says, the next consideration takes us beyond this emphasis upon loss of the object. If the infant longs for the sight of the mother, it does so only because it already knows from experience that she gratifies all its needs without delay. The situation which the infant appraises as danger and against which its desires reassurance is therefore one of not being gratified, of an increase in tension arising from non-gratification of its needs, a situation against which it is powerless. And of course, we mentioned this earlier on, that this inability to delay gratification is brought on by the parental situation. It's a form of pathology. But in the dynamic of the family, if the child is not correctly raised, then it will enter into the world as a destructive and uncivilized creature who simply cannot delay its own gratifications. Freud goes on to say, the initial cause of anxiety, which the ego itself introduces, is therefore loss of perception of the object, which becomes equated with loss of the object. Loss of love does not yet enter into the situation. Later on, experience teaches that the object may continue to be present, but may have become angry with the child. And now loss of love on the part of the object becomes a new and far more enduring danger, an occasion for anxiety. The mixed messages. The child just simply can't work out whether it's wanted or it's not wanted, whether it's truly loved or it's hypocritically loved. And it just goes round and round forever in the psyche of the child. The division begins. The inner war begins between the heart and the mind, the superego and the ego, the superego and the conscience, the self and the world. Now, Dan P. McAdams, in his book, The Person, An Introduction to Personality Psychology, says that anxiety begins to form in the relationship between the infant and the mother, when the infant senses the mother's anxiety. Well, isn't that something? We've been talking along about the child's anxiety. Now we find out it's a dumpster for the anxiety of the mother and the parents and the neighbors and whoever else. That's a good one. But you're going to see how important that statement becomes as we proceed. On the concept of flooding, Percival Simmons says that anxiety is very much an affair of the ego. It is something the ego must learn to manage in some way, either by tolerating it in small quantities or by warding it off. When anxiety becomes overwhelming, the reactions become diffuse and disorganized. Disintegration in itself is frightening, and the very process of disorganization adds to the anxiety. Now, anxiety is very much connected to self-image, what is often called self-schema by the psychologists. The psychologist Ernst Hilgard, speaking of this self-image or vision of oneself or self-schema, says, if one wants to understand a person's defenses against guilt, we must know something of his images of himself. When we look up the term self-schema online or in an encyclopedia, we read that the term self-schema refers to the beliefs and ideas people have about themselves. These beliefs are used to guide and organize information processing, especially when the information is significant to the self. Self-schemas are important to a person's overall self-concept. A person's self-image is the mental picture, generally of a kind that is quite resistant to change, that depicts not only details that are potentially available to objective investigations by others, such as height, weight, hair color, gender, IQ score, and so on, but also items that have been learned by that person about himself or herself, either from personal experiences or by internalizing the judgments of others. Speaking of the pseudo-self and the connection to the parents, Alexander Lowen says that parents fail to provide sufficient nurturing and support on an emotional level by not recognizing their children's individuality. But they also seductively try to mold them according to their image of how they should be. It is the distortion that produces the narcissistic disorder. As I said, one of the greatest experts on the subject of neurosis is Karen Horney. One can't understand anything about neurosis or almost any other disorder without a knowledge of her works and the way that she differed with her colleagues. It's my belief that her greatest discovery, her greatest insights, had to do with the pseudo-self, which she refers to as the idealized image, and then later that develops into an idealized self. It's basically a counterfeit self. Horney says, most of all, the individual, alienated from himself, needs, it would be absurd to say, a substitute for his real self, because there is no such thing. But he needs something that will give him a hold, a feeling of identity. This could make him meaningful to himself, give him a feeling of power and significance. Gradually and unconsciously, the imagination sets to work and creates in his mind an idealized image of himself. In this process, he endows himself with unlimited powers and with exalted faculties. He becomes a hero, a genius, a supreme lover, a saint, a god. She goes on to say, the idealized image becomes an idealized self, and this idealized self becomes more real to him than his real self. The change is in the core of his being, in his feelings about himself. It is curious and exclusively a human process. Feelings about himself, way of seeing, in the core of his being. After all he's had to put up with by being born into the world, he rejects utterly his true self. Self-murder, the greatest act of evil imaginable, because it is the seed, the nucleus of all other aberrant characteristics and activities in the world. Horney says, the process of enhancing and maintaining the idealized self parallels the process of enhancing and developing the authentic self. So we might want to think of it as some sort of mirror image, some hideous, distorted Jekyll and Hyde distortion. The energy that you're now giving to this pseudo-self is in some hideous parallel to what in some other universe, in some parallel Star Trek universe, you would have been doing with your real self. That's laid to rest into the grave, and the pseudo-self is born. I've often said in my other work that the ego is quite literally the ghost that arose from the grave of the self. Horney says that neurotics with an idealized self dislike doubting themselves. They prefer to blame others. So much energy goes into producing and maintaining the pseudo-self, as well as in attaining goals, that self-doubt is considered a great threat. In this way, the neurotic positions himself against reality. He becomes inflated, arrogant, opinionated, self-aggrandizing, presumptuous, hostile, outer-directed, embittered, uncompromising, and vindictive. She says, having an idealized self, the neurotic is free to imagine a love beyond all other love. He fantasizes that there is a divine love that will be all good and all healing. Under such an image, other lesser loves can be seen as inferior. The root of this lies in the neurotic's belief of his own unlovableness. Since he has no self to love, and since he believes that no one will love him truly for himself, well, he's free to imagine an unrealistically sublime kind of love that is quite unreachable. In actuality, the love that appeals to the neurotic is that which simply meets his neurotic needs, those of his idealized self. Since these needs are often contradictory, they can never be sufficiently or permanently met by the love of another, let alone by another neurotic. You have a pseudo sense of self. As I said, you have a pseudo kind of love. And the neurotic's biggest problem in the world, the thing that really is one of the things contributing to the difficulty that he has, is that the world happens to be chock full of other neurotics in the same predicament. In fact, most neurotics and others with pathological disorders, but specifically the neurotic, their biggest problem is how to adjust to the world. It's not about finding the self and lamenting what's going on inside their heads. Their biggest peeve is their effectiveness in the world. Karen Orney goes on to say, surveying self-hate and its ravaging force, we cannot help but see in it the great tragedy, perhaps the greatest tragedy of the human mind. Man, in reaching out for the infinite and absolute, also starts destroying himself. When he makes a pact with the devil, who promises him glory, he has to go to hell, to the hell within himself. That's right, the neurotic's in a state of inner chaos, inner war. And we, in meeting that kind of person, are caught up in it. If we endorse that person's idealized image, we're friends, we're good to go. But if we, for any number of reasons, influence that person differently or try to speak to that person's higher self or treat them as a self, treat them in a human way, that relationship may break up, dissolve. This is the predicament. Speaking about the neurotic, Karen Horney says that the neurotic in analysis rarely changes for the better. He merely adopts a new set of shoulds. The neurotic situation therefore remains the same as it was. Forget about the disgraceful creature you actually are. This is how you should be. And to be this idealized self is all that matters. So it's the counterfeit self that's coming for psychotherapy. It wants tips on how to be more effective, how to adjust better to an abnormal, insane or unsane society. So you might as well go and have a makeover. Go down to the local spa and have a makeover. That's exactly what the neurotic is doing. It's just renovation. It's got nothing to do with seeking for the truth. In regards to therapy, Arno Gruen says that they, neurotics, want therapy to make them like the rest of us, well-adjusted, obedient, successful, and with the freedom to act in a destructive way, like other people. He says many patients enter therapy not in order to preserve their human feelings, which they perceive as a hindrance, but to be liberated from them. And of course, what happens to a person who's that outer-directed, that selfless, who's now absolutely chronically dependent on the approval of everybody else and since we know that we don't often get that approval, what's the next step? Fix it. Fix the world. Fix all the problems. Don't do it psychologically or spiritually, but let's get into politics. Let's get into all sorts of pseudo-solutions. Caronone says that when a person feels that his life for good or ill is determined by others, it is only logical that he should be preoccupied with changing them, reforming them, punishing them, protecting himself from their interference, or impressing them. In this way, externalization makes for dependence upon others. It also makes for an over-dependence upon external stimuli. He thus acquires the characteristics that Jung calls extroversion. She says that feelings of inferiority and inadequacy are characteristics that never fail. They may appear in a number of ways, such as a conviction of incompetence, of stupidity, of unattractiveness, and they may exist without any basis in reality. Notions of their own stupidity may be found in persons who are unusually intelligent, or notions about their own unattractiveness in the most beautiful women. She says, the fear of disapproval is very common in neuroses. Nearly every neurotic, even though he appear on the surface observation to be entirely certain of himself and indifferent to the opinion of others, is excessively afraid of or hypersensitive to being disapproved of, criticized, accused, found out. He feels guilty because, as a result of his anxieties, he is even more than others dependent on public opinion. In his book, Emotional Vampires, Albert Bernstein writes, imagine a date with a man or woman of your dreams. You talk of nothing in particular, yet you desperately search your companion's every word for clues to what he or she really thinks of you. Your heart soars at any tiny signs of acceptance and falls to the pit of your stomach at the slightest hint of rejection. The point being, we've all got it. We've been pointing out that we're not generalizing. We all have sadistic traits. We all have anger. We all have masochistic traits, and we all have the desire for approval. But we don't often kill off our true self in order to have those things or in order to be those things. The types that we're talking about are obviously extreme cases, extreme examples of this. And we have to search our own souls and see how far along that spectrum we are. Are we selves or are we submitting? Are we trying to bring meaning from within ourselves? Or are we waiting for the world to bring it to us? You know, have we lost ourselves in order to be clinging to the approval of people who will never give us the approval or who may be equally as neurotic as we are? It's this catabolic, apophatic way of looking at life that actually brings us upon the truth about what's going on. Horny talks about the approval also. She says, the craving for affection is so frequent in neuroses and so easily recognizable by the trained observer that it may be considered one of the surest indicators for an existing anxiety and its approximate intensity. Well, that tells us something, doesn't it? Because if you happen to be a person who doesn't necessarily crave all that approval and doesn't chronically require it, well, you're less neurotic. She says, the neurotic wish for unconditional love, however, is much more comprehensive than the normal one, and in its extreme form, it is impossible to fulfill. It is a demand for love, literally without any condition or reserve. This demand includes, first, a wish to be loved regardless of any provocative behavior. The neurotic demand for unconditional love includes, second, a wish to be loved without any return. Karen Orney goes on to say about the chameleon-like nature of neurotics, often the need to impress others is in the foreground, and their alienation from self makes it possible for them to change their personality according to the requirements of the situation. Chameleon-like, they always play some role in life without knowing what they do, and like good actors, produce the feelings that go with the roles. In other words, a neurotic will do whatever they can to sustain this pseudo-reality. They're in a chronic state of need, not love. But of course, need, no matter how it is camouflaged, no matter how it's disguised, is simply not love. As we saw in one comment earlier, neurotics, like a lot of these other pathological types, resist healing. It's very difficult. The success rates are abysmal. Hence the work in this program, to try and go deeper, look at the thing in a different way, sidelight it differently, turn it around. Now, Sigmund Freud was asked about that. Why is it so difficult for neurotics to change or to be healed? And what the object of psychotherapy was. And he said something remarkable. He said that the purpose of psychoanalysis was to replace neurotic suffering with ordinary human misery. Now that we've looked at the neurotic vampiristic type, let's move forward and look at the narcissistic vampiristic type. Now, narcissism must be divided into its healthy and unhealthy forms. Unhealthy narcissism is known as malignant narcissism, and normal people, so to speak, have normal narcissistic traits. They're normally narcissistic. But when it comes to the more malignant type, we find that it's men who make up the largest demographic of narcissists. We also find out that there's at least five different kinds of narcissist. There's the phallic or elitist narcissist, there's the amorous narcissist, there's the unprincipled narcissist, and the fanatic. And some experts say there's even more than that, various different categories of the disorder. One thing that must be stated at the outset, though, is that when psychologists speak of narcissism, they're certainly not using that term as we would use it on the street level. It does not equate with self-love at all. In fact, quite the opposite. We may remember in Greek legend, Narcissus wasted away after falling in love with his own image or reflection. In other words, the mirror image replaced the true self. Inferiority plays a big role. Alexander Lowen, in his book Narcissism, says, "In common parlance, we describe a narcissist as a person who is preoccupied with him or herself to the exclusion of everyone else. A closer view of narcissistic personalities is given by Otto Kernberg, a prominent psychoanalyst. In his words, narcissists present various combinations of inferiority and overdependence on external admiration and acclaim." So there we have it again, the same syndrome that we saw with the neurotic. Eric Fromm, speaking about the self-loathing of the narcissist, says that the narcissist is not so much concerned with getting things for himself as with admiring himself. While on the surface it seems that these people are very much in love with themselves, they actually are not very much in love with themselves. Their narcissism, like selfishness, is an overcompensation for a basic lack of self-love. Now, when we look up narcissistic personality disorder online, we read that people who are diagnosed with narcissistic personality disorder use splitting as a central defense mechanism. They do this to preserve their self-esteem by seeing the self as purely good and the others as purely bad. The use of splitting also implies the use of other defense mechanisms, namely devaluation, idealization, and denial. Martha Stout, in her book The Sociopath Next Door, writes that narcissism is, in a metaphorical sense, one half of what sociopathy is. Clinical narcissists are able to feel most emotions as strongly as anyone else does, from guilt and sadness to desperate love and passion. The half that is missing is the crucial ability to understand what other people are feeling. Narcissism is a failure not of conscience, but of empathy, which is the capacity to perceive emotions in others and so react to them appropriately. Nina Brown, in her book The Children of the Self-Absorbed, speaking of the traits of the average destructive narcissist, says that they expect you to immediately drop what you're doing and attend to them. They use your possessions without asking permission, enter your room without first knocking or waiting for permission, and they want, ultimately, to control what you do or say. They withhold approval, even when work is completed well. They have an understated sense of disapproval, resentment, arrogance, superiority, righteousness, justification, malice, and anger. And there's constant disapproval, like talk of sin and karma and retribution, or foreboding or pessimism. As Albert Bernstein, in his book Emotional Vampire, said, they'll make your life hell getting you to heaven. And time plays a factor too. Christopher Lash, in his book The Culture of Narcissism, says that the narcissist has no interest in the future because, in part, he has so little interest in the past. That ties into this capacity of neurotics and narcissists and so on to edit their history. We're going to see more about that later on. The ability to literally forget their own past history. When you're not looking too closely, it looks like a positive virtue that they're living in the present, they're living in the now. Instant gratification plays a large part in destructive narcissism. Alexander Lowen says, it is significant, for instance, that narcissistic characters and psychopathic personalities show a need for instant gratification, an inability to contain desire or tolerate frustration. Roy F. Baufmeister, in his book Evil, Inside Human Cruelty and Violence, says that in 1990, a general theory of crime by Gottfriedson and Hershey, two eminent criminologists, appeared. The general theory that they proposed was essentially one of low self-control. Most crimes are the result of a lack of inner discipline and restraint. Christopher Lash says that the sensationalistic and narcissistic individual can be aptly compared to a child at play. Their abnormality is demonstrated, however, in the fact that they interact and react to all aspects of life like a child at play. They do not know when to take things seriously or when to be serious. In fact, they're of the belief that nothing need be taken seriously. They are very disturbed when anything serious is imposed into their life space and when matters of importance demand attention. Everything is taken lightly and casually. Everything is taken for its entertainment value. In a minute, we'll see that Alexander Lowen addresses something very important. It's this concept of the difference between sensation and true emotion. Again, if you're not looking very closely, mere sensationalism can appear identical with true emotion. Well, they're not the same thing at all. Lowen says that narcissists do show a lack of concern for others, but they are equally insensitive to their own true needs. Christopher Lash says, the narcissist is shallow but is extremely adept at hiding this fact. As part of their game playing, they soon become expert at charades. The narcissist is never serious because they take nothing seriously. At some time in their life, they make the decision to not be disturbed by taking things heavily. Upon once experiencing the discomfort of an intense emotion, or after once experiencing a series of major emotional upheavals, their ego decides to avoid such again. It develops a casual attitude to all things and all happenings. It turns the contrast and the volume levels way up on life and casts away all the shadows from the room, so to speak. In this way, their fragile egos are secure. He goes on to say that no deep emotion penetrates at all at any time. As soon as potentially heavy experiences approach, the narcissist finds a way out, a way to quickly and dramatically disengage or make an exit. Even if this means losing face or losing friends or losing one's entire mode of life at a given time, the narcissist goes ahead. Changing the external pattern of their lives is preferred over facing what mode of life brings in the way of trouble or intensity. Nothing can change the ego orientation of such a person, and one must be wary of the narcissist and his or her patterns in order to avoid personal loss and heartbreak. Dealing with such a type, one who cares nothing other than for their own pleasure, can result in some serious consequences domestically, emotionally, and materially. The relative pleasure that comes from a temporary interlude or relationship with such a person is later canceled when their true extrovert and sensationalistic tendencies and drives become clearly apparent. Sam Vakin, in his work Malignant Self-Love, speaks about the hunger for approval. He writes, the sick narcissist's sense of self-worth and self-esteem derive entirely from audience feedback. Alexander Lowen says, all of us need others. If we have a sense of self, we need another person to share it. But even if we lack a sense of self, like the narcissist, we still need others to support and applaud our self-image. Without the approval and admiration of others, the narcissist's ego becomes deflated, for it is not connected and nourished by self-love. Christopher Lash says that narcissism represents the psychological dimension of dependence. Notwithstanding his occasional illusions of omnipotence, the narcissist depends on others to validate his self-esteem. He cannot live without an admiring audience. His apparent freedom from family ties and institutional constraints does not free him to stand alone or to glory in his individuality. On the contrary, it contributes to his insecurity, which he can overcome only by seeing his grandiose self reflected in the attentions of others, or by attaching himself to those who radiate celebrity, power, and charisma. For the narcissist, the world is a mirror. Now, as we can see from some of these comments and a few to come, this chronic need for approval ties directly into vampirism. You're literally addicted to the energy. Approval is energy, isn't it? So you're addicted to the approval and the energy of other people. Christopher Lash writes, because the intrapsychic world of these patients is so thinly populated, consisting only of the grandiose self, in Kernberg's words, the devaluated shadowy images of self and others, and potential persecutors, they experience intense feelings of emptiness and inauthenticity. Although the narcissist can function in the everyday world and often charms other people, not least with his pseudo-insight into his personality, his devaluation of others, together with his lack of curiosity about them, impoverishes his personal life and reinforces the subjective experience of emptiness. Lacking in any real intellectual engagement with the world, notwithstanding a frequently inflated estimate of his own intellectual abilities, he has little capacity for sublimation. He therefore depends on others for constant infusions of approval and admiration. He must attach to someone, living an almost parasitic existence. At the same time, his fear of emotional dependence, together with his manipulative, exploitive approach to personal relations, makes these relations bland, superficial, and deeply unsatisfying. The ideal relationship to me would be a 2-month relationship, said a borderline patient. That way there'd be no commitment, and at the end of the 2 months, I'd just break it off. On their inability to love either themselves or others, Alexander Lowen writes, narcissists have a fear of intimacy because it requires an exposure of the self. One can't be intimate and hide behind a mask or image. But physical closeness makes no such demand and can be used to hide the self and feelings. Narcissists may use sexual closeness as a way to avoid true intimacy. As a result, sex becomes a mechanical act. Lauren E. Peterson, in her book Dark Hearts, The Unconscious Forces That Shape Men's Lives, speaks of the cause of narcissism. She says, this internalized mother love leads to what is sometimes referred to as primary narcissism, a high regard for oneself that is part of an enduring and healthy sense of self-worth and self-love. But without this healthy love for oneself, there is little hope for a healthy love of the other. Nina Brown, in her book Children of the Self-Absorbed, speaking about destructive narcissists, says that the destructive narcissist will often have difficulty in developing and maintaining meaningful relationships. They will have numerous partners, marry and divorce often, and flit from person to person in search of the perfect friend. They choose partners and friends on the basis of what that person can do for them, especially in terms of status. Some people with DNP only have friends that they consider to be superior in status. These are the very lonely and empty people. They seem to have no core and substitute activity for relationships. They may seem to give a lot to their relationships, but on closer examination, it becomes clear that they aren't genuinely responsive to others and are intensely self-focused. She says, adults with healthy narcissism not only have a wide range of emotions, they're also able to experience intense positive and negative emotions, On the other hand, the destructive narcissist has a restricted range of emotions, and almost all of these have the depth of a line. The destructive narcissist will be able to use the correct words for emotions, but will not have the feelings associated with the words. For example, they will use words like happy and joy correctly, but will not be able to actually feel happiness or joy. They don't seem to be able to express milder forms of these emotions, like annoyance, sadness, or apprehension. They are unable to speak more positive emotions with any feeling. Even experienced clinicians have difficulty diagnosing narcissistic personality disorder or pathological narcissism at first. It seems that it takes a period of contact with the person before the pathology emerges. Further, the diagnosis depends a great deal on the reactions of the therapist to the person. This difficulty occurs because the pathological narcissist is usually very adept at disguising their behaviors and attitudes. It's almost impossible for a therapist or anyone else to identify these aspects in someone as characteristic of destructive narcissistic personality disorder until they've spent some time with the person. Under fixation with external appearance, Alexander Lowen says, narcissists are more concerned with how they appear than with what they feel. Indeed, they deny feelings that contradict the image they seek. Acting without feeling, they tend to be seductive and manipulative, striving for power and control. They're egoists, focused on their own interests but lacking the true values of the self, namely self-expression, self-possession, dignity, and integrity. Narcissists can be identified by their lack of humanness. They don't feel the tragedy of the world threatened by a nuclear holocaust, nor do they feel the tragedy of a life spent trying to prove their worth to an uncaring world. Narcissists, say Lowen, love their image, not their real self. They have a poor sense of self, and they're not self-directed. Instead, their activities are directed toward the enhancement of their image, often at the expense of the self. Narcissistic characters are not just better, they are the best. They're not just attractive, they're the most attractive. As psychiatrist James F. Masterson points out, they have a need to be perfect and to have others see them as perfect. And actually, in many cases, narcissistic characters can display numerous achievements and seeming success, for they often show an ability to get along in the world of power and money. On appearance, Lowen goes on to say, I have been struck by how many narcissists look younger than they are. They even have features of smooth complexions, which do not show any lines of worry or trouble. These people do not allow life to touch them. Specifically, they don't allow the inner events of living to reach the surface of their minds or the surface of their bodies. Their eyes are dull, no light shines through them, and there's no expression or feeling. This dullness of the eyes in no way reflects a dull mind. Schizophrenics' eyes have a far away or vacant look, as if they were looking past you. While a part of them sees and hears you, part of them is off somewhere else. They see you, but not as a feeling being, only as an image. It is as if they were seeing you as a reflection in a mirror. There is an important break with reality in the narcissist's personality, but it's not the same as the schizophrenic's break with reality. One would never call a narcissist crazy, however much a degree of insanity may be present in the depths of his or her personality. And given what we're hearing here, we can understand that the narcissist who's chronically addicted to looking good and showing off and thinking he's the greatest isn't going to be happy with the aging process. And of course, they're not. It compromises their entire structure, characterologically. In the case of Eric, as discussed by Alexander Lowen, another aspect of narcissism that was evident in Eric's personality was the need to project an image. He presented himself as someone committed to doing good for others, to use his own words. But this image was a perversion of reality. What he called doing good for others represented an exercise of power over them, which, despite his stated good intentions, verged on the diabolical. Such exploitation is common to all narcissistic personalities. Lowen says, as I see it, narcissists are perfectly adapted to the world we live in, They subscribe to its values. They flow with its constantly changing patterns, and they feel at home in its superficiality. Psychopathic personalities are not necessarily what society calls losers. They are successful psychopaths, according to Alex Harrington, who made a study of these personalities. Brilliant, remorseless people with icy intelligence, incapable of love or guilt, with aggressive designs on the rest of the world. Such an individual may be an able lawyer, executive, or politician. So his point is, yeah, we're not talking about some panhandling, night-stalking aqualung here. We're talking about the top boys. It's top-heavy, pathocratic world we're living in. Unsane, toxic world that literally is almost custom-made for pathology. Lowen says, the image also serves an external function in relationship to the world. It's a way of gaining acceptance from others, a way of seducing them, and of gaining power over them. And again, he emphasizes the central point. A personality disturbance occurs when there's a lack of congruence between the self-image and the self. The severity of this is in direct proportion to the degree of incongruence. This discrepancy is most marked in schizophrenia, where the image bears almost no relationship to reality. Mental institutions contain people who see themselves as Jesus Christ or Napoleon or some other renowned figure. In narcissistic disorders, the incongruence is less than in schizophrenia, but is sufficient to produce a split in identity. And it's very easy for us to think of media characters like a famous James Bond character as a classic example of the narcissistic personality. And then back to parenting again. Lowen lays it on the line. He says, I regard all narcissism as secondary, stemming from some disturbance in the parent-child relationship. And Sam Vaken agrees. He says, idealization is an important developmental path leading to narcissism. The child merges the idealized aspects of the images of his parents. Now, the smothered and spoiled child is dehumanized and instrumentalized. His parents love him not for what he really is, but for what they wish and imagine him to be, the fulfillment of their dreams and frustrated wishes. The child becomes the vessel of the parents' discontented lives, a tool, the magic airbrush with which they seek to retouch their failures into successes, their humiliation into victory, their frustrations into happiness. He says the child is taught to give up on reality and adopt the parental fantasies. Such an unfortunate child feels omnipotent and omniscient, perfect and brilliant, worthy of adoration and entitled to special treatment. The faculties that are honed by constantly brushing against bruising reality, empathy, compassion, a realistic assessment of one's own abilities and limitations, realistic expectations of oneself and of others, personal boundaries, teamwork, social skills, perseverance, and goal orientation, not to mention the ability to postpone gratification and to work hard to achieve it, well, all are deficient or missing altogether. Lowen says, although I believe the narcissist's disorder is a product of Western culture, I also believe that narcissistic individual is a product of an unhappy family situation in which the child is seduced into a special relationship with one parent. Through the intimacy provided by that relationship, the child is exposed to and overstimulated by adult feelings and adult sexuality. And let us remember that a child who is stimulated sexually by a parent has no possibility of discharging the excitation. On the capacity for fantasy, Percival Simmons writes, the child rejected by his parents is also narcissistic. The child who is denied love by his parents is thrown back on himself for love. He's forced to find pleasure in himself rather than in persons and experiences outside, and frequently is driven to autoerotic practices in an attempt to derive the pleasure denied him in his contacts with others. Such a person builds a fantasied instead of a realistic appraisal of himself. He magnifies himself through daydreams as he becomes his own hero in fantasied exploits. He becomes aggressive, goaded by the necessity of wresting a good opinion of himself from the outside world by forcible means. His attempt at gaining power is his insurance against the underlying belief in his own unworthiness. Narcissism based on rejection is rooted in emotional insecurity and tinged with anxiety. The person who is fundamentally unsure of himself but builds himself up in a fantasy and in self-stimulation is unfit for social relations with others. And now that we've looked at the narcissistic traits, the narcissistic vampiristic traits, let's proceed to look at the sociopathic vampiristic type. In the vast majority of sociopaths, there are three common characteristics. They're exceptionally egocentric, they're legends in their own minds, they have zero empathy, and are absolutely incapable of remorse, shame, or guilt. In other words, they're basically incurable. These people have so far gone in destroying their own inner self that no external person, I don't care how many degrees they've got and how many white coats they've got in their dresser, they're not going to be able to handle it. And experts accept this, that the success rates when it comes to some of these pathological types, particularly sociopaths, is very, very low. Well, one in about 25 to 30 people are psychopathic or sociopathic. The majority, again, are men. About 30% of men are sociopathic, and about 1 out of 10 females. It's less conspicuous in the East, like in India and China, but certainly increasing again in the West. Martha Stout, speaking of the increase of sociopathy, says that, disturbingly, the prevalence of sociopathy in the United States seems to be increasing. In the 1991 Epidemiological Catchment Area Study, sponsored by the National Institute of Mental Health, reported that in the 15 years preceding the study, the prevalence of antisocial personality disorder had nearly doubled among the young in America. It would be difficult, closing on impossible, to explain such a dramatically rapid shift in terms of genetics and neurobiology. Apparently, cultural influences play a very important role in the development, or not, of sociopathy in any given population. We saw that earlier on, that you can't blame it on DNA and heredity and heavy metal. This kind of dysfunction is not necessarily organic, it is very much a situation of environment causing it. Martha Stout goes on to say, there are more sociopaths among us than people who suffer from the much publicized disorder of anorexia, 4 times as many sociopaths as schizophrenics, and 100 times as many sociopaths as people diagnosed with the known scourge such as colon cancer. Roy Shepherd and Mary T. Cleary, in their book That Bitch, say that sociopaths are rarely physically violent, but are often unscrupulously cruel and ruthless with their victims. About 70% of sociopaths, they say, grow up without a father. And what are the chances of spotting a sociopath? Zero, or nearly zero. Hence this program. We got to start somewhere. Lots of experts are either completely taken in or it's still in the early stages of understanding what even creates people like this. Martha Stout says that sociopaths are invisible and are not as conspicuous as murderers and so on. They're almost impossible to detect. The common traits associated with typical sociopath is a reduced electrodermal skin responses to distress cues when slides are showed to them, a decreased response to fear imagery and to threats. They have difficulty processing emotional information. They over-respond to distractors. That means they have poor concentration and focus. They have a habit of speaking more quietly, and they certainly cannot delay gratification. There it is again. And they may even derive, or in many cases do derive, pleasure from causing upset and pain to other people. Other common traits are shallowness, the poverty of emotion, extroversion, narcissism, deceitfulness, impulsivity, lack of remorse, irresponsibility, the total disregard for the welfare and safety of others, and promiscuity. Fromm says, the intensely destructive person will show a front of kindliness, courtesy, love of family, of children, of animals. He will speak of his ideals and his good intentions. But not only this, there is hardly a man who is utterly devoid of any kindness, of any good intention. If he were, he would be on the verge of insanity. Hence, as long as one believes that an evil man wears horns, one will not discover an evil man. One of the experts on sociopathy, Harvey Checkley, says that a so-called psychopath is ordinarily free from signs or symptoms traditionally regarded as evidence of a psychosis. He doesn't hear voices. Genuine delusions cannot be demonstrated. There is no valid depression, consistent pathological elevation of mood, or irresistible pressure of activity. Utter perceptual reality is accurately recognized. Social values and generally accredited personal standards are accepted verbally. Excellent logical reasoning is maintained, and in theory, the patient can foresee the consequences of injudicious or antisocial acts, outline acceptable or admirable plans of life, and ably criticize in words his former mistakes. The results of direct psychiatric examination disclose nothing pathologic, nothing that would indicate incompetency or that would arouse suspicion that such a man could not lead a successful and happy life. Lauren E. Peterson says that the sociopath's lack of love for others is not offset by a love of self. His entire life seems to be a continual loveless act, which in one way or another culminates in self-destruction. Now, doesn't that make sense from what we looked at earlier? What would be the fate of an individual who can't act out without being penalized and has no chance of resurrecting his inner self? Is that person heading for harmony and paradise? Is a society that is neurotic, narcissistic, and sociopathic heading for utopia, and global utopia and brotherhood of man? Absolutely ridiculous. Destruction is the only possible end. There's a way to fix it. We'll look at those solutions later. But if these situations are not remedied, and remedied in a healthy and knowledgeable way, then how can anyone avoid destruction? If you choose the path of irrationality, expect destruction. Now, hatred, of course, is deeply involved with all of this. Human hatred. And Fromm says, only a relatively small number of people have an awareness of their fundamental dislike of others. Many have only a feeling of just having little interest or feeling for others. The majority are completely unaware of the intensity of the chronic hatred in themselves as well as in others. And again, speaking about the early origins of sociopathy, Lauren E. Peterson says, as far as we know, sociopathic personalities are formed very early in life. By late adolescence, the antisocial pattern of behavior has become well established, characterized by often frightening criminal and exploitative behavior and shallowness in all relationships. One of the leading experts on psychopathy and sociopathy, Robert Hare, says that while few psychopaths commit violent crimes, the callousness of the average psychopath usually ranges through subtle but still devastating misdeeds. Parasitically bleeding other people of their possessions, savings, and dignity. Aggressively doing and taking what they want, shamefully neglecting the physical and emotional welfare of their families, engaging in an unending series of casual, impersonal, and trivial sexual relationships, and so forth. Rebecca Horton, in her book The Sociopath, writes, not only do they covet possessions and power, but they gain special pleasure in usurping and taking from others. What they can plagiarize, swindle, and extort are fruits far sweeter than those they can earn through honest labor. And once having drained what they can from one source, they turn to another to exploit, bleed, and then cast aside. Their pleasure in the misfortune of others is unquenchable. People are used as a means to an end. They are to be subordinated and demeaned. Speaking about the power over love dynamic, and Harvey Checkley writes that the psychopath seldom shows anything that would pass even in the eyes of lay observers as object love. His absolute indifference to the financial, social, emotional, physical, and other hardships which he brings upon those for whom he professes love confirms the appraisal during psychiatric studies of his true attitude. I mentioned they were incurable. Well, Carl Goldberg says that forensic psychologists and psychiatrists and criminologists recognize that the likelihood that a seriously destructive person will reverse his or her adverse behavior is poor. Neither conventional psychoanalysis nor any other form of psychotherapy or rehabilitative program has been consistently effective with these clients and inmates. Arno Gruen puts his finger on the truth. He says, despising and hating everything that is human is a condition that might define a typical sociopath. Well, try curing that. Eric Fromm calls it necrophilia as opposed to biophilia. Right? We have an urge, an instinct that is life-giving, negentropic. Then we have the destructive, it's like entropy. We have the creative self and then we have the destructive self. And here he's saying that these individuals are completely necrophiliac. Something in them is so dark, so corroded, so completely fragmented, so deviant, that they are just pure destroyers. Oh, granted, helped by the world, helped by the media, helped by the fashion industry, the cosmetics, and general superficiality of the human mind right now, they're able to just walk amongst us like the ghosts that they are, unseen. Invisible predators, the parasites. If they have a problem, it's usually another one of their own kind that they have to deal with. Great. That's wonderful. That'll really help. When we look into the work of Hervey Checkley, we see that his book, Masks of Sanity, originally published in 1941, provided the most influential clinical description of psychopathy in the 20th century. The term mask of sanity derived from Checkley's observations that, unlike people with major mental disorders, a psychopath can appear to be normal and even engaging, while typically not suffering overtly from hallucinations or delusions. However, the mask covered a concealed psychosis. Speaking of the vanity of the sociopathic type, Aaron T. Beck, in his book Prisoners of Hate, says that professionals who have worked with psychopaths have been struck by their extreme egocentricity. They are totally self-serving, feel that they are superior to others, and above all, think that they have innate rights and prerogatives that transcend or preempt those of other people. Now, Rebecca Horton, speaking about their charm and allure and mystique, says that while the psychopath has likes and dislikes and fondness for the pleasures that human company can bring, analysis shows that he is completely egocentric, valuing others only for the enhancement of his own pleasure or status. He's generally superficially charming and often makes a striking impression as possessed of the noblest of human qualities. She says that people with this disorder appear to be charming at times and make relationships, but to them these relationships are in name only. They're ended whenever necessary or when it suits them, and the relationships are without depth or meaning, including marriages. They seem to have an innate ability to find the weakness in people and are ready to use these weaknesses to their own ends through deceit, manipulation, or intimidation, and gain pleasure from doing so. They appear to be incapable of any true emotion, from love to shame to guilt. Horton goes on to say, not all psychopaths are uneducated, low-class misfits. Some of them are quite handsome and have good careers and use this all the more to their benefit. Take a look at Ted Bundy. My friend's mother once went on a double date with him and claimed he was the nicest person. His mother said he was the best son any mother could have. Bundy was also apparently quite good-looking, which made him even more dangerous. So not all psychopaths are derelict, low-class, high school dropouts. There are many who also work in professional occupations. On the question of deriving great pleasure from other people's suffering, Arno Gruen writes, only hatred and destructiveness give them a feeling of aliveness. Only through rage and murderousness can they attain a feeling of wholeness and a heightened sense of self. Derek Wood, in his Antisocial Personality Disorder Overview, says that antisocial personality disorder results in what is commonly known as sociopathy. The criteria for this disorder requires an ongoing disregard for the rights of others since about the age of 15 years. Some examples of this disregard are a reckless disregard for the safety of themselves or others, a failure to conform to social norms and respect to lawful behaviors, deceitfulness such as repeated lying or deceit for personal profit or pleasure, and lack of remorse for actions that hurt other people. And the sociopath is never to blame. Hervey Checkley writes, "The psychopath apparently cannot accept substantial blame for the various misfortunes which befall him and which he brings down upon others. Usually, he denies emphatically all responsibility and directly accuses others as responsible. But he will go through an idle ritual of saying that much of his trouble is his own fault. When the latter course is adopted, subsequent events indicate that it is empty of all sincerity. Although his behavior shows reactions of this sort to be perfunctory, this is seldom apparent in his manner. This is exceedingly deceptive and is likely to promote confidence and deep trust. More detailed questioning about just what he blames himself for and why may show that a serious attitude is not only absent, but altogether inconceivable to him." Roy F. Baumeister, on the same subject of never being to blame, having no conscience, says that John Arians has compiled a set of letters and other writings by prisoners on death row in the United States, and these killers do not see themselves as evildoers. "I am the hunted, the caught, the prey, the victim of the crafty, the cunning and powerful," as one wrote. And this capacity to never take blame is a conspicuous red flag for the sociopath. Checkley says that after being caught in shameful and gross falsehoods, after repeatedly violating his most earnest pledges, he finds it easy when another occasion rises to speak of his word of honor, his honor as a gentleman, and he shows surprise and vexation when commitments on such a basis do not immediately settle the issue. Rebecca Horton, again speaking of the mind games and the reverse psychology, she says that often a psychopath will turn on the victim and claim that the victim suffers from delusions and is not mentally stable. Watch out for that one. She also speaks about their capacity for mimicry. Mimicry is often used to convince others that the psychopath is a normal human being. He does this to create the false empathy with his victim. The psychopath will try to make you believe he has normal emotions by spinning some sad tale or professing profound, moving experiences. The truth is, most psychopaths go through life as if in an incubator, touched by few and having no real compassion for others. But they will lie to convince you that they have normal emotions. The pity factor is one reason why victims often fall for these poor people. Lying is like breathing to the psychopath. She says, "The most amazing thing, however, is their selective memory. A psychopath might not remember the promises he made to you yesterday, but he will remember something from the past if it suits his purposes in some way. They often do this whenever they're confronted or caught in a lie." And then when we look deeply at sociopathy, take it on its own, look back and say, what could possibly be the causes of this? Where do we end up? Back in the domestic situation, back with the parents. The behavior of sociopaths, as with all other people, is never senseless. It's never a matter of DNA, hormones, or as I said, heavy metal that drives them to antisocial behavior. Jason Eric Massey was an American murderer who was executed in 2001 for the murders of two people. Massey was neglected and abused by his drug-addicted mother. By his teens, he was a juvenile delinquent with a lengthy criminal record, mostly for stalking and torturing animals. His mother once sent him to a psychiatrist after discovering his journals, in which he detailed his fantasies about rape and murder, his hero worship of Charles Manson, his avowed Satanism, and his strong desire to become a serial killer. We have the case of Gary Gilmore, who murdered two young men in cold blood and then refused to appeal his death sentence. He was executed in Utah in 1977. Michal Gilmore, Gary's younger brother, did an extensive search of his family's history to try and determine where things went wrong, particularly since of the four brothers, Gary was the only outwardly violent one. Michal traces family secrets, extreme emotional neglect, religious rigidity, and bouts of physical abuse that his brothers endured back to his grandparents, both sets of which rejected the two children who grew up to become Gilmore's parents. He begins his memoir by mentioning that all of his family, save he and his older brother, are dead. Of five children, one died as an infant, one of complications from being viciously stabbed, one by execution, and the other, brother, simply wandered away. The reader immediately knows that severe dysfunction is at the heart of his family. So it is not surprising to learn that his father, Frank Gilmore Sr., was a con man, a gypsy, an alcoholic, a brutal autocrat, and an abusive husband and father. Aaron T. Beck relates the story of Terry. He says that although Terry, the sociopath's behavior at home was attributed to bad temper, the core of the problem resided less in weak control or impulsivity as in his negative beliefs about other people. He continuously pictured himself as the innocent victim. He assumed that other children and teachers picked on him because they enjoyed it. When asked about his feelings about other students, he said, "They're my enemies." Sometimes he would react to discipline at school by seeking a weaker target, usually one of the girls who he would tease, pinch, or shove. When admonished by the teachers, again his explanation was, "She started it." When his parents attempted to confront him with a specific report of misconduct, he would simply deny it ever happened. "It's not true. She made it up." Well, now that we're familiar with these three important pathological types, neurosis, narcissism, and sociopathy, we can now exclusively focus on the vampiristic type of personality. According to Joe Slate, author of Psychic Vampires, vampirism is a widespread phenomenon. He writes, "Psychic vampirism is, without doubt, one of the most intriguing phenomena involving human behavior. It is also one of the most complex. It's easy to mistake psychic vampirism as either fictional or simply more juicy sensationalism. But a closer look reveals a serious reality, so common that almost everyone has had some experience with it." He says that psychic vampirism is alive and flourishing in the world today. While its existence spans centuries, it has never been more widespread, nor its effects more profound. Psychic vampirism is a widespread yet often unrecognized human energy phenomenon that can interrupt your growth and impede our progress. It exists in many forms, each of which subtly consumes its victim's energy and over the long haul erodes the energy system itself. Although no known force can totally destroy the human energy system because of its cosmic makeup, psychic vampirism can impair its functions and seriously damage its capacity to energize growth. At the beginning of the program, we mentioned how important energy was and how the great experts who are solving disorders never mention energy or the interchange of energy. Prana, chi, libido, doesn't matter what you call it. It's the fundamental basis of everything that is. And as we said earlier, one could think of it as some kind of food or nutrient, a basic food, a basic nutrient that sustains the whole cosmos. Slate goes on to say, "The vampire has depleted their own energy. They are the self-murdered. Their condition is not fixable because the damage has already been done. The existence depends wholly on parasitical energy theft. The victim's survival depends entirely on energy boundaries and psychic protection." The psychic vampire, he says, who is deficient in energy resources, taps the energy reserve of a host victim for the express purpose of extracting energy from it. The immediate effects vary, but usually include a new surge of revitalizing energy for the psychic vampire and a critical depletion of essential energy for the vampirized victim. Well, let's never forget Elizabeth, Countess Elizabeth Bathory, allegedly bathed in her victim's blood to make her younger, more revitalized. Physically bathed in her blood. The same concept applies, but it's bathing in the energy of someone else, like standing beside a beautiful waterfall to feel the spray so that you are invigorated. Well, powerful, good, creative, moral people, their proximity often can work like that. They're downloading spirit, aren't they? Well, an empty man, a self-destroyed man, might feel invigorated in the company of such individuals. Murray Stein, in his book Jung on Evil, talks about this energy depletion. Evil, within the psychological realm, he says, is equivalent to entropy in the physical realm. It is the tendency within a system to run down and to disintegrate, a flow of energy toward destruction. Good, by contrast, is equivalent to negentropia, the flow of energy in the opposite direction, towards building systems up into greater levels of integration and complexity. Jean Bolin, in her book The Ring of Power, gives us a line that could be the motto of the vampiristic type. She says, I am convinced that we enter the world seeking love, but when we don't find love, we settle for power. Now, we can accept that there's a phenomenon known as sadomasochism. It's actually called algolagnia. And this is the idea that one person has dominion over another person physically. Well, that's right. It's the same dynamic as power versus love, or dependency versus independence, or selfhood versus self-murder. It's all based on a lack of selfhood and self-knowledge, all based on an avoidance of legitimate suffering. And Peter Tosh, the singer, says that vampires don't come out and bite your neck anymore. They cause something destructive to happen, that blood will spill. And those invisible vampires will get their meal. And on the appearance of the vampire into your life, I write, vampires appear in your life while you are undergoing a major emotional upheaval. Trouble does not, however, abate after the vampire appears. In fact, it continues. Trouble and conflict is the mark of the vampire. Eventually, after their infection spreads, opportunities fail to come in, failure occurs instead of expected successes, good ideas lead nowhere, plans are mysteriously sabotaged, sound allies suddenly turn into rivals, and you make inexplicably poor judgments, and your good state of mind or your good mood are drastically compromised. I say that an evil person is an emissary of evil, a conduit for greater evil than exists within themselves. This is why their proximity is so disadvantageous. They are map stealers. While you're not looking, they attempt to steal your life map, leaving you without a sense of direction. Their presence makes you doubt or downplay every accomplishment and true friendship you have. Their presence functions like an infrared lamp that changes the color of everything in its rays. Barbara Hort, in her book Unholy Hungers, says that the vampire soul has been ravaged by its hunger. It cannot be moved to mercy by the agony of its victims. The human beings who fall prey to the vampire are stripped of their humanity and reduced to lumps of life in the vampire's maw. The vampire's hunger is heartless as well as soulless, and its victims must perish in a cold pit where they scream without echo or answer into the blackest inhuman void. On the self-destroyed individual, Eric Fromm says the destructive and cruel person has become so because he lacks the conditions for further growth. Fromm has described them as existential failures. Other experts call them constitutionally inferiors. Constitutional inferiors. I refer to them as morally inferior beings. John Lash, in his book Twins and the Double, says that the vampire occupies a curious niche in mirror lore. As a member of the living dead, a vampire is a double of a once living person, but now the original of the double has been totally eliminated. Since the double can have no double, the vampire can have no reflection. The vampire, it seems, is a twin type who may be viewed as representing the ultimate face of narcissus. The vampire lives in perpetual need of refueling itself off its victims, who in turn are turned into blood-sucking doubles. Now, one of the most important techniques to be aware of when it comes to vampiristic types is this mimicry we touched on earlier. I refer to it as walking in rhythm with you. It's a technique that they use, especially in the early stages. The vampire falls into lockstep with you during the early stages in order to acquaint themselves with your particular rhythm, so to speak. They seek to lull your suspicions and evoke a sense of camaraderie and trust. When you give someone your love and trust, you also make the fundamental mistake of imagining that they are reciprocating in kind. It is upon this irrational assumption that sorrow takes root. Gradually, the expert vampiristic type succeeds in lowering your defenses. You're left wide open. Your mansion can now be plundered. Their attack is all the more easy if you are a naturally giving, caring, and trusting person. If you stick to your suspicions, They will berate you as being overly suspicious, paranoid, and untrusting. And the more that your life works on routine, the more fixed your schedule, behavior, and attitude, the worse it will be, and the easier it will be for the vampire to become acclimatized to your world. Now, we notice something about parasites like mosquitoes. Before they can actually suck your blood, they actually inject some of their own saliva as some sort of anesthetic into your blood first. That happens first. So the charm and the giving and the sense of camaraderie that comes with these people in the beginning, that's that anesthetic, so that you won't notice your life force being drained off. It's as if vampires bathe us in honey. In the end, we end up dead of an overdose of sweetness. Have you ever seen a fly trapped in honey? It had a sweet death. Martha Stout says that when a sociopath identifies someone as a good game piece, she studies that person. She makes it her business to know how that person can be manipulated and used. And to this end, just how her chosen pawn can be flattered and charmed. In addition, she knows how to promote a sense of familiarity or intimacy by claiming that she and her victim are similar in some way. Victims often recall statements that affected them even after the sociopath was gone, such as, "You know, I think you and I are a lot alike," or, "It's so clear to me that you are my soulmate." In retrospect, these remarks can feel supremely demeaning. Outrageously untrue, they haunt the mind nonetheless. I write that the vampire uses a technique known as second attention. They frequently employ such terms as, "We have so much in common," "We're meant to be together," "I never met anyone like you," and "I dreamed that someone like you would come into my life," and "I've never been equal to my previous partners," or "I've never felt truly challenged before." They seduce one or belittle one with statements such as, "I can be with anyone, but I choose to be with you," and "I would not be with anyone if you and I were not together," or "If we broke up," and "Don't have any expectations," "Don't be attached to outcomes," "Be in the flow," or "Be in the light," and so forth. Basically, when you're in the presence of one of these creatures, it's thraldom. It's a form of auto-hypnosis, or sort of entrainment, as it were. They operate almost like a convex lens. Every one of us likes to be in the company of people who make us feel good. Well, the vampire does that, but just a little bit more. Just like a convex lens, they reflect back your natural good traits, the stuff that you love about yourself and you feel good, and just that touch more. They inflate your sense of self-importance just a tad more than other people do. And that is one way that they use to get you into their thrall. Now, on their charm and allure, Martha Stout says that, "I've watched people shake their heads and make statements such as, 'He was the most charming person I'd ever met,' or 'I felt like I'd known her forever,' or 'He had an energy about him that other people just don't have.'" Another important thing about the vampiristic type is that really at the bottom line, whether the energy coming at them is love or hate, it won't matter ultimately at the end of the day. It might start out as something wonderful, but ultimately it's all about energy. So love or hate, take your pick. They'll be satiated one way or the other. If they can elicit from you strong emotions, whatever kind, emotional, jealousy, anger, whatever it may be, it's all an exchange of energy at the end of the day. Joe Slate says that given recurrent attacks, the victim's energy supply can become chronically depleted, and the internal energy system itself can become severely damaged. Driven by dark, malicious forces, the psychic vampire seeks not only energy, but domination, and in some instances, even destruction of the unsuspecting victim. Albert J. Bernstein, in his book Emotional Vampires, speaking about their infantilism, says that emotional vampires never grow up. Throughout their lives, they see themselves as victims of fate and the unpredictability of others. Stuff happens, and they just respond to it. He says all the patterns derive from the fact that the emotional vampire sees the world differently than other people do. Their perceptions are distorted by the cravings for immature and unattainable goals. They want everybody's complete and exclusive attention. They expect perfect love that gives but never demands anything in return. They want lives filled with fun and excitement, and to have someone else take care of everything and anything that's boring or difficult. Vampires look like adults on the outside, but inside they're still babies. Vampires themselves are usually not aware of the childish needs that drive them. Envy is also one of the traits that we associate or should associate with vampiristic types. Envy is, a lot of people argue, is at the root of almost all the other vices. But envy is certainly a mainstay when it comes to vampiristic behavior. But envy of what? Well, envy of what they themselves don't have, and that's inner beauty. The vampire, I say, lacks inner beauty, but deeply covets it. Indeed, it is the one thing that truly tantalizes them and awakens their deepest hunger. They crave inner beauty because it's the one thing they do not possess. They have a love-hate or attraction versus repulsion relationship with beauty. Now, two types of person are capable of recognizing true inner beauty: those who possess inner beauty themselves and those who have lost it or murdered it themselves. The problem is that the person with the inner beauty may mistake the latter person for the former. They may convince themselves that they are in the presence of another being with inner beauty and not realize their mistake until it is too late. On the connections between envy and destruction, Martha Stout says that since it is simply not possible to steal and have for oneself the most valuable possessions of another, like beauty, intelligence, success, strong character, the covetous sociopath settles for besmirching and damaging enviable qualities in others so that they will not have them. As Milden says, here the pleasure lies in their taking rather than having. And that is, by the way, one of the definitions of envy. It's different than jealousy. In jealousy, you don't care if the other person's got something that you admire. In fact, you're probably glad for him. So jealousy is born out of a virtue. Envy is the state in which you're thinking to yourself, I know I can't have it, or I know I can't make that, but I just don't want him to have it. It's very, very dark and pernicious. And we need to learn how to test for it. Another crucial aspect of this relationship with the vampiristic personality type is the concept of courting. It's just a word that emphasizes the interchange between energy. Now, Art Martin says that people in your life who want to control you or leech off your energy can attach cords to you. Quite often, it is another physical person who is courting you. They are trying to hold on or extract energy from you. Dark forces are attracted to people who are doing well in their life. They want to stop them and sidetrack them, and so they do anything they can to block your path. Joe Slate says that vampire attacks can occur during physical contact, such as a handshake or touch on the shoulder, or they can occur at distances of up to many miles. On courting, I say that in the average relationship, there is constant amicable exchange of energy. This exchange is dramatically different in the vampiristic relationship. There, the exchange is involuntary. The vampire crosses the boundary and takes that which he has no right to take. Whatever he gives back in return for what he takes is inadequate and does not replace what he takes. The victim is always shortchanged. He will not realize it in the early stages. He will not realize it if he does not inherently value himself. He will not realize it if he's an altruist who compulsively puts the needs of others before his own. I say that the life force within the vampire is low. There is barely any vital energy within them. Only the lower chakras are active. The higher centers or chakras of energy are completely inactive. Therefore, they attach themselves to people whose higher centers are open and active. They literally plug into that energy. As we said, it's like standing in front of a waterfall. Eventually, the centers of the host become exhausted and begin to shut down. The victim's own bioenergy drops, leading to symptoms of illness and mental and emotional unrest. One is out of the palace and into the sewer, into the gutter. I kind of liken it sometimes to a couple of cogs. You have the big cog, they're the small cog, but if they plug into you, then it's your energy that's moving their cogs. And also, I must also add that in all the books that have been written on this phenomena, all of those authors only write about the exchange of energy in one way, which is that the vampiristic kind of individual sucks, if you want to use that term, your energy, drains off your life force. But in fact, my research has shown that that's only 50% of the situation. Your actual field of energy can also be used in the opposite direction as a processor for their toxic, deathly, vile energy. And this has not been touched on by any other source on this subject. And in a way, that is one of the things that causes a secondary level of pathology. You are going to get ill, you're going to get sick, not just because your life force has been, you know, drained off or used or abused, but because you are now a surrogate processing engine for the toxicity of these people. In other words, you become something like their conscience, the very conscience they don't have, that repressed, negated, buried self we talked about earlier. That's the mirror of the pseudo-self. Could you be the external representative of that? Well, you are, if you're going to hold the light for somebody. So in my work, I see the attack in these two forms, not just that your energy is simply drained in the traditional way of understanding, but that you may have been used potentially from childhood, potentially continually through your life, as a dumpster, as an energy processor. What are you going to do about that? It's like picking pepper out of a meal. Oh, but the meal's already made. How are you going to do it? Well, that's some study, isn't it? It's the road of selfhood. It's the road of return to yourself. It's soul retrieval. The vampire does not, I say, as is supposed, merely suck your energy or life force. Their attack is much more involved than that. The vampire essentially uses your energy field to process their own toxic bioenergetic energy. Simply put, they use people as dumpsters. And Eric Fromm, again, explains the heart of it. What does the hypnotic and especially the post-hypnotic experiment prove? He's talking here about hypnosis. It proves that we can have thoughts, feelings, wishes, and often sensual experiences which we subjectively feel to be ours, and yet they've been put into us from the outside. They're basically alien and are not what we think, feel, and so on. I say that this means that one is used as a surrogate, conscience. One is literally a surrogate, a cleaner, a rust remover. The vampiristic person need you to clean their energy, provide direction, inspire them to action, provide physical security and sexual titillation, and so on. And in fact, it is this particular influx of their energy into your field that really constitutes true vampiristic attack, by the way. This is nothing less than a colonization of your force field, of your energy, of your libido. It's nothing less than psychic rape, a kind of domination. And you end up being plunged into a maelstrom of distress and loss and doubt and suspicion and so on. You're like a remote control mannequin or zombie after they're done with you. On courting, Karen Horney says that closely akin to the attitude of compliance and interwoven with it is the emotional dependence which results from the neurotic's need to cling to someone who holds out the promise of protection. This dependence not only may cause endless suffering, but may even be wholly destructive. In relationships in which one person becomes dependent on the other, there is invariably a great deal of resentment. Eric Fromm, speaking about the sexual version of it, the sexual courting, says that suffering from an awareness of his powerlessness and separateness, man can try to overcome his existential burden by achieving a trance-like state of ecstasy, to be beside oneself, so to speak, and this to regain unity within himself and with nature. There are many ways to accomplish this. A very transitory one is provided by the nature of the sexual act. This experience may be said to be the natural prototype of complete concentration and momentary ecstasies. It may include the sexual partner, but too often remains a narcissistic experience for each of the two, who perhaps share mutual gratitude for the pleasure they have given each other, conventionally felt as love. Fromm goes on to say, it is not true that sexual satisfaction is the cause of or identical with mental health and happiness. Often psychologists see patients whose ability to love and to be close to others is damaged and yet who function very well sexually, and indeed make sexual satisfaction a substitute for love because their sexual potency is the only power in which they have confidence. Their ability to be productive in all other spheres of life and the resulting unhappiness is counterbalanced and veiled by their sexual activities. Anina W. Brown agrees. She says the destructive narcissist will often have difficulty in developing and maintaining meaningful relationships. They will have numerous partners, marry and divorce often, and flit from person to person in search of the perfect friend. They choose partners and friends on the basis of what that person can do for them. These are very lonely and empty people. They seem to have no core. They may seem to give a lot in their relationships, but on closer examination, it becomes clear that they aren't genuinely responsive to others and are intensely self-focused. Albert J. Bernstein, speaking about seduction, says that emotional vampires look better than regular people. They're bright, talented, and charming as a Romanian count. You like them, you trust them, and you expect more from them than you do from other people. Well, you expect more, but you get less, and in the end, you get taken. You invite them into your life and seldom realize your mistake until they've disappeared into the night, leaving you drained dry with a pain in the neck, an empty wallet, or perhaps a broken heart. Even then, you wonder, is it them or is it me? And when it comes to parents, I write that malignant vampiristic parents who live off the energy of their children, who envy their children's vitality and innocence, often drive their children to schizophrenia or other pathologies. There are cases on record showing that the health of parents got worse as their children's health improved. As the schizoid tendencies and delusions subsided, as their children turned to a semblance of normalcy, the parents actually became more aggressive and more psychotic. The mind games they played with their unfortunate children, their unfortunate victims, came to an end, and the self-absorbed parent lost control. By labeling their children schizophrenic or whatever, and having professional sympathy, parents can now offload all their domestic problems onto the child's behavior and nature. This is a praying mantis syndrome. The praying mantis literally offers up its head after the mating is over for the edification of the partner. Well, children offer their minds up to their parents so that the parents can use that field vampiristically, parasitically. The field, the energy, the chi, the libido of a child, the innocence of a child, not only as the crutch in the normal way we understand, but on a much more sinister and deeper level with these children that even develop extreme syndromes, extreme complexes. Barbara Hort says something very, very important. We assume the psychic vampire to be one of us, a person with an empathic soul that resonates with other souls and wishes them well. As I said in the beginning, in our introduction, if somebody's nice, you imagine they have a conscience. If you project love and trust onto somebody else, you automatically, without a single iota of proof, imagine that you're getting it in return. We project our goodness onto other people, and that's fine if those people are good or moral. But if you project your goodness and your morality and your virtue and your standards onto a person who's basically a walking graveyard, what do you think the result is going to be? And Albert Bernstein says that we can establish two absolutely non-negotiable facts about the nature of pure evil. We know that an evil person accepts no responsibility whatsoever for their own dysfunctional anti-human actions. This means that, unlike other people, when they act in an unloving manner, they do not acknowledge it or take responsibility for the consequences of their act. Indeed, in their minds, the other person is responsible. If they feel sad or broken, it's their affair. There's no empathic resonance with the suffering of the other person, and no accountability. Indeed, the evil person imagines that it is the other person's own actions that have led to their despair and undoing. Since this is often true to a point, the evil person's retorts and abuse may go unseen. It's not so much that these vampires think they're better than other people, as that they hardly think of other people at all, unless they need something. So, what have we learned through all of this process and all of these incredible insights into pathology? Well, we've learned that there's a thing called the vampire equation, basically. The vampire equation is dysfunctional parenting plus oppressive society plus the creation of an idealized image or idealized self, plus this dependency on approval, equal self-murder, equal vampirism. We've also seen now that my definition of evil, equating it with self-murder, has a great deal of merit. And we've seen something about this incredible relationship between the good and the evil. It's been written about a lot, but we're seeing it from maybe another kind of light here, that the immoral man almost needs the moral man to exist. The good man almost, or the evil man almost, depends upon the existence of his counterpart. It's a strange relationship. And normally we'd think in daily life, a good man's behavior and energy would repel a malicious or evil person. Well, that's true to some, in some circumstances. But there's another, even more perfidious reality, and that is that the evil ones, the empty ones, the self-murdered ones, are attracted to the inner beauty and bounty and innocence and what have you of a good man. And good people, good men and women, do not deserve to be treated in this malignant way by people of that nature, do they? And we've seen that an unsane society certainly contributes to pathology. Schizoid individuals will create a schizogenic society, yes, but it works the other way as well. Society contributes to all forms of derangement, emotionally and mentally. We've seen that as that society becomes more hectic, more artificial, more extrovert, that these pathologies such as anxiety, neurosis, narcissism, sociopathy, not to mention the suicide and other forms of violence and war and what have you, they're going to be on the increase as well. The two go together. We've certainly seen how little actual freedom exists in what we call infancy with most families. And we've seen that what constitutes normal development, well, genuine parental attention, rational affection, and a healthy relationship with the external world. Those are absolutely non-negotiable facts. We've seen that we as human beings seem to want to avoid not only self-knowledge but the experience of legitimate suffering. Remember the Freud quote about replacing the suffering, that so-called suffering of the neurotic, with legitimate misery of human beings? There's something rich and real about that. We've seen how extroversion plays into this, that the self-murdered person is now entering into that customized world that's just ready and waiting to fill him with all that stimuli so he never even has to think about himself. We've seen that the medical profession is certainly interested in perpetuating sickness, or if not even manufacturing these disorders. Ties in with our comments on society, doesn't it? We've seen how important it is for us to monitor our own emotions. How do we feel in the presence of other people? Do we ever actually think about that? This person's just come into the room, or this person's just talking with me, and suddenly my mood has changed. 5 minutes ago I was in a good mood, now I kind of feel different. Has something happened in that time? Yeah, well, the people passing you. We live, as I said, in a plasma of people, a constant interchange of energy. We're not to assume that other people's frequency is the same as ours. We've seen that just because you, again, it needs to be repeated, just because you extend love and trust to somebody else does not mean that they're reciprocating at all. And we've seen how our chronic need for dependency leaves us wide open, potentially wide open to evil. We've seen that we must not allow the world to give us meaning, we must do it for ourselves. Ultimately, spiritually speaking, we've got to come to the point, we've got to come to the understanding that nobody has anything we need psychologically and emotionally. It's all within our own capacity, it's all within our own hands. I mean, what would happen in the world if we all understood that, that we don't need any other human being for what we need emotionally and psychologically? That doesn't mean you become a hermit and stop existing in the world and sharing and caring, but you don't do it to the extent where you give over your whole sense of self to other people, I don't care who they are, mother, father, teacher, priest, guru, God, or whatever. Because the thing is this, if you're inclined to do that, then look what you inherit. All forms of tyranny, I mean, we're looking here at the roots of evil, aren't we? Well, let's make it very simple. If you don't do what we're talking about and you say, nope, I'm just going to continue the way we are, aren't you endorsing all the tyrannies that exist? Aren't you actually helping plant the seeds of evil, not just of the medical leviathans or of dysfunctional parentings or psychic vampires running loose in the world and sociopaths and what have you? I've said time and time again that external reality mirrors psychic reality. The world is shaped by consciousness. Now we're seeing exactly what that means. We've seen that so-called mental or emotional disorders, as they're now called, is basically boils down to ways of seeing. It's feelings that we have about ourselves, whether they're constructive or deconstructive, healthy or unhealthy. It's all a matter of choice. We certainly learned that goodness does not exist in everyone. Conscience is not universal. And just because that evil, you know, interior can be disguised and hidden behind a veneer of niceness, and because it's relatively effortless for evil people to disguise themselves, doesn't change that fact. Another interesting way to look at this, which again goes up to a more higher perspective, is that we encounter evil people, we encounter these kinds of challenges, partly because it's ordained. It is a journey towards selfhood. Maybe we're encountering them because there's something in them that needs to be in the proximity of people who are good. And vice versa, we need, by contrast of their nature, to know truly what selfhood and love and compassion really are, by contrast. There is some sort of weird link between the good and the evil. It's a love-hate, attraction-repulsion dynamic. From this we can determine, what is sanity? Well, Nina Brown tells us that it's creativity. It's the ability to delay gratification. It's the assumption of responsibility. It's meaningful relationships. On the lack of self-love, Robert A. Johnson says that despite our ecstasy when we're in love, we spend much of our time in a deep sense of loneliness, alienation, and frustration over our inability to make genuinely loving and committed relationships. Usually we blame other people for failing us. It doesn't occur to us that perhaps it's we who need to change our unconscious attitudes, the expectations and demands we impose on our relationships and on other people. And Karen Horney says something absolutely magnificent. It is, she says, in reality, not so terribly important that people in general should like us. It may, in fact, be important only that certain persons do like us, like those whom we care for, or those with whom we have to live or work, or those on whom it is expedient we make a good impression. But apart from such individuals, it is fairly irrelevant whether we're liked. Neurotic persons, however, feel and behave as if their existence, happiness, and security depended on being liked. Carl Jung puts it this way: if things go wrong in the world, it is because something is wrong with the individual, because something is wrong with me. Therefore, if I'm sensible, I shall put myself right first. For this I need, because no outside authority no longer means anything to me. I need a knowledge of the innermost foundations of my being, in order that I may base myself firmly on the eternal facts of the human psyche. We found out that there's a big difference between shame and guilt, and a big difference between conscience and superego, between empathy and just the veneer of niceness. And we've also learned something about suffering, the nature of suffering. It's summarized by Arno Gruen, who says, in our society, it is not those who suffer that are weak, but those who fear suffering. People who have made the most successful societal adjustment actually turn out to be the weak ones. To conceal this fact, the well-adjusted have for millennia been propagating the myth that sensitivity means weakness. They are the ones who perpetuate a distorted view of reality, that is, the ideology of power and domination. He says, the strength that grows out of sorrow, distress, helplessness, illness, and bitter pain has to do with the kind of transcendent experience that brings inner fortitude, which is not contingent upon external power and its constant need or reaffirmation. The suffering involved in discovering one's own self is of an entirely different nature from the suffering that opts for salvation by identifying with something outside the self. Only those who can endure their own suffering are capable of establishing themselves as a separate entity. Robert Johnson says that suffering is the inevitable path that must be trod on the way to consciousness, the inevitable price for the transformation we seek. By no means can we escape it. We who try to evade it never succeed, and we are twice unlucky, for we pay the price anyway, but miss our transformation. There is a terrible and immutable law at work. We only transform when we take our suffering consciously and voluntarily. To attempt to evade it only puts us into the karmic cycles that repeat endlessly and produce nothing. Arne Gruen, on the same matter, says that to bring such people back to what they rejected about themselves so long ago means to accompany them on a journey of self-confrontation so painful that suicide, an outbreak of psychosis, or some other dire result may ensue. And I want you to meditate on what he just said there, because it's not just the individual who's going through this. The whole of society does. Nations do. The avoidance of who we all are, done on a colossal scale, has an impact on our civilization. On a more simple note, I hope that we've discovered just to have, you know, stronger boundaries in our normal relationships. Don't put yourself up for sale to the first person that comes along. Have a statement of higher value. Don't let other people take the reins of your life. Try to discover how it is that your need and your weakness and your desires for the approval of others absolutely makes you a slave in the world. And if you are in a state of slavery, you're not going to be able to free anybody else, even if it's under the name of love. I hope we've also learned that vampiristic types, like other pathological types, are not particularly rational people. I mean, after listening to the information we provided here, you can hardly say they're logical or rational. In fact, irrationality is the cause of the problems that they're suffering. So therefore, don't expect them to act rationally. Don't be so willing to entangle and engage with irrational types and go round and round and round chasing your own tail. When you try to break free from a vampiristic type, be also very aware that the problems will amp up. They won't get less, because vampire types often know ahead of time that you're ready to make a break. You know, they can sense your discontent and what have you. And at that time, they're ready to take out, you know, 15, 16 more, you know, bin bags that they had hidden away in the cover of darkness and dump them in while the going's good. So be very careful about that toxic overload. Be very aware of the fact that they're not going to do the reverse psychology on you. Take a Polaroid of your madness, take a Polaroid of your anger, show it to all their mates, put it in the album, so that when they do a runner, you're standing there going, was it me or was it them? Watch out for that. Disengage. Have your own witnesses. Prepare things. Be clever. Act rationally. Be aware of their profile, their psychology. The guilt tripping that they'll pull on you, and the blame that they'll put on you, and the pity partying, and the comparisons with you and other people, and so on. There's a whole slew of them we don't have time to go into here. And of course, my personal point with all of this is that under no circumstances ever forgive evil. Save your tears for the victims. I hope this makes sense. Don't send them blessings. Don't send them good feelings to those who are evil and hug them and forgive them and all this nonsense. This is what got you into the problem in the first place. This is what is recommended by a lot of different books out there. It's certainly not what I recommend. Your lovingness, your caring, your hospitality, and your humanity. Now, remember we said the projection of your own virtues onto them brought them in the door. Don't be giving them more of the same. That's not logical. Understand that they don't have any conscience. Don't expect them to change. Remember the princess and the pea? Just keep adding the mattresses. Well, it'll be simpler to take away the pea, no? Well, guess not. These people live in the soundproof room of their own narcissism, of their own pleasure principle, and you are as disposable as a truck, a broken truck, or a broken soldier in the hands of an infant. So don't become a fixer. It's all about soul retrieval, taking back energetically what they've taken from you. It's about self-exorcism, but that means drawing the circle of protection around yourself. As a Taoist, I've learned always that good does in fact come out of evil in many instances. Homeopaths know that, that the body is made of qi and energy and that it needs to be strong, and that sometimes, yeah, we have to meet people that test us. Somebody once said that you're judged, your merit, your strength, your power is often judged in the power of your adversary. So if powerful, devious, dark adversaries come into your life, look at it one way, look at it in the Zen way. What does it say about your strength and your sovereignty and your morality? As Goethe said, our friends show us what we can do, our enemies show us what we must do. Barbara Hort reminds us of the same idea. She says, all Luciferian characters and experiences have the ability to illumine us. The word comes from lucem fera, meaning light bringer. So in adversity we grow. Do you know that the most beautiful flowers are grown by prison inmates? Creation out of destruction. It's the same with our lives. We talked in the beginning about one of the major themes of this program, which is to try and live sanely in an unsane world, a world at skyrocketing rates of depression, and people being medicated, and suicide, and even open violence like war. Well, the whole idea of being able to do that involves psychic hygiene. That's what sanity is. I've defined it before in other work. In fact, it's a curious etymological fact that the words sanity and the word sanitize seem to have similar roots. Dr. Robert Holden, the founder of the Happiness Project, says that unless you are happy with yourself, you will not be happy with who you are with. Your relationship with yourself sets the tone for every other relationship you have. Eventually, everyone must pay for your own self-hatred. And one final point is that I do foresee, I've been tracking their progress, these low success rates in so many key areas, but I do predict that in a short time, in the near future, hopefully, the medical profession, the healers of the world, are going to have to factor in this concept that we've been talking about and exposing throughout this program. Vampirism, this exchange of energy, not just in the traditional one-way mode, but in both ways. Because that particular processing of dark energy through your system, that pollution, is obviously the cause of a bunch of secondary pathological syndromes, yours, or that person who's sitting in a psychiatrist's room saying, hey doc, I don't know what's wrong with me, I feel depressed, I feel lonely, I feel alienated. So in other words, there's secondary anxiety, the anxiety that is now being felt throughout the world by decent people all over the world, who are being drained and drained and drained in some hideous way by these invisible parasites whose lives seem filled with bounty and abundance and happiness and pleasure. Of course, we know it's all fake and faux and pseudo, but nevertheless, why is it that people have to suffer, the good suffer? We've got to factor this in, and I believe that that is going to happen sooner or later. Joe Slate says, in a recent survey conducted by the author, of 82 healthcare professionals, including clinical psychologists, counselors, social workers, and physicians in the southeastern United States, only 8 were familiar with the term psychic vampire, and only 1, a clinical psychologist, reported having treated a victim of psychic vampirism, and in that instance, the patient had already diagnosed her condition before seeking therapy. Carl Goldberg says that we're still not clear why people do the appalling things to each other and to themselves, because psychoanalysts and other clinicians have only treated the symptoms of malevolence, ignorant of its causes. Evil remains elusive, able to exert virtually the same awesome and perplexing power as it always has done. When this step is taken, when healthcare professionals factor in vampirism as here described, it is then that we will, in my opinion, see the beginning of the end of evil.